Amen's top news headlines of the day from CMR.
Good morning, Sandy. How are you?
Good morning, Blake and Aaron.
That was a long weekend.
Fantabulous. How are you guys?
We are good on a Tuesday morning.
Awesome.
So supposedly you've got some big headlines this morning, I'm guessing?
Yes, of course.
We all saw the letter from over the
weekend. It would never be a real weekend, a real holiday weekend without big headlines. So
yeah.
On the political front, apparently Mr. Bush has agreed to resign, but there's a little bit of controversy around his decision to resign.
Okay.
What is that?
The controversy is the first announcement actually came from the Minister of Planning and Infrastructure, Mr. the Honorable Jay Ebanks, whilst the two of them traveled to Honduras on Friday. Mm-hmm. And then the premier had to issue a statement on Saturday to say, oh, but the speaker had already agreed to that, as Mr. Ebanks would have known.
Huh.
Hmm.
That's weird. So is the premier in, did he go to London?
Yes, that's right.
He's
busy in London.
I was going to say, he's going to do this really fast. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Did you ever get the speaker on the phone on Friday?
No, we did not.
Oh,
we did not answer the phone on Thursday.
So Thursday, okay.
Yeah, he did not answer the phone. So in other news, and we'll be discussing that whole situation this morning if anybody's interested.
I'm sure.
Yeah. There will be no real consequences for Ms. Kayman. The committee has confirmed that despite facing 6 assault charges, she, including multiple for assaulting police, she will not lose her title at this particular time. She will get a stipend despite the fact that she isn't working at DOT. So the deputy governor basically is refusing to allow her to work because anybody else in a contract or any other civil servant would have been suspended from work once they're arrested. So at least that much has been done. But they're still paying her a stipend and she doesn't have to work. She gets to keep all of her prizes, including a $70,000 3-year scholarship. And the only thing that they've said is she won't be making any public appearances, but she's still very much active on social media and posting every day. So I don't know what they count as public appearances, but she's certainly not disappeared from the public eye. That's for sure.
That's interesting.
It sure is. Hurricane Fiona hit the island of Puerto Rico over the weekend. First, it devastated Guadalupe as a tropical storm. The photos were shocking what it did as a tropical storm, as severe damage. But it didn't stop there. I mean, it looked, I don't know if you've seen these, Blake and Aaron, but it looked really, really bad when it hit Guadalupe. And then it moved on to Puerto Rico as a hurricane, with everyone in Puerto Rico being without power, took out the entire island, total blackout. And it could take a number of days for them to start trying to restore power.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it was a nasty little storm that kind of crept up.
I heard 100,000 people have power back now.
They finally got a little bit of power. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it made landfall near the Cape of Punta Tocan in the southern Puerto Rico area around 3:20 p.m. on, I believe that was on Saturday. Packing sustained winds of only 85 miles per hour, but still, it was definitely one to watch. So President Biden has approved an emergency declaration for Puerto Rico on Sunday, which authorizes the Department of Homeland Security and the Federal Emergency Management Agency to try to coordinate some emergency disaster relief for them.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll be keeping them in our thoughts and prayers for sure, because everybody knows how devastating these storms can be, even if they're not a full hurricane. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, over the weekend, there was the official funeral of Queen Elizabeth, the late Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. Did you guys get to watch it at all?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We watched all of it, basically.
And it was 6 hours worth of...
marching,
just pumps, and I mean it was just amazing. Like, I could not believe how well organized it was. Went off without a hitch.
Mm-hmm.
And
I gotta tell you, I was watching it, I was always most nervous with watching the pallbearers.
Yes.
Like, I just, you know,
that was rough.
Yes, one little misstep, like walking up the stairs.
Yeah,
you know, all those stairs up into the chapel, I was like, oh my gosh, please Please don't drop that. That would be.
I think this is, they've got this down.
Like, I know, but you know, one of the
maybe they train like every day.
But one of the guys that was guarding the coffin, remember, he fell over. It's like you just don't want something bad to happen. I was always just nervous when they were handling the coffin.
And the RCIPS was there representing. So they actually had six RCIPS officers who traveled to London.
That's pretty cool.
And yeah, they took place in the ceremonies on Monday. So that was really cool.
Yeah, the Royal Mounted Police were actually leading the parade.
Yeah, I was going to say
the procession.
The procession, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so... really, really amazing to watch. I watched a lot of it and it was just like, wow.
Yeah.
So, all right. Pretty cool. So those are your news headlines this morning.
All right. Catch Sandy's show on Bobo 89.1 FM coming up at 7:30. We'll see you tomorrow for Wednesday headlines. All right.
Sounds fantastic, guys.
All right. Our segment brought to you.
All right, folks, we are going to get started this morning. Good morning to everyone. Let me just grab my links real quick. And, then we can get started. Oh, let me make sure I'm logged into Bobo. Oh, yeah. Sometimes I forget to do this part. This part is really important so that our radio folks can actually hear me. And then I will grab our links, everybody. Mm-hmm. How was the holiday weekend? All right, here we go, folks.
Peppermint, sorrel, ginger, fever grass, or English. Get it ready. Your morning tea just got hotter.
Ooh, honey chow.
On the cold, hard truth. Bobo 89.1 and Cayman's number one talk show are bringing you morning talk like no one else. Monday Rewind, Impact Wednesdays, Caribbean Connections, and much more. Don't miss a beat with what's happening in the local community. Just keep sipping your tea.
What a mess.
Here's your host, live and direct from the Cayman Islands, Sandy Hill.
Caymanians and our non-Caymanian friends from all over the world, happy Tuesday. Hope you guys had a fabulous long holiday weekend. I pray and hope that your employers followed the law. You guys know who you are. There's one in particular that has a retail store in town that we really heard quite a bit about. So I know someone who knows her. Who knows the owner, and I'm going to reach out to her because she seems to have been really, really confused about what the law required of her on the holiday Monday. And, you know, we don't want to have to feature you on CMR now, honey child. Get it together. If you're in business and you can't afford to hire an HR manager, you had better well ensure that that you know what's going on, that you understand the law. It's as simple as that. So someone says radio has a weird sound. Okay, let me send that to Chuck. That is most likely on their end. I don't think that has anything to do with me. So I will send that to him right now. Thank you for letting me know. It's just unbelievable. Anyway, listen, it's been quite the weekend. I hope you guys had a really safe weekend. Thankfully, there was nothing major in terms of any accidents or anything like that to report, just the usual fender benders, about 20 a day. You guys didn't get the memo about safe driving over the weekend, clearly. But we got really, really important things to talk about today. So I'm going to dedicate this entire day to the topic of politics. OMG. Normally I wait until Friday because I feel like, you know, you've de-stressed over the entire, well, you not de-stressed, but you probably were stressed out the whole week. And then we can unpackage it all on Friday. But it seems to me like, that's just not going to happen this week because y'all just don't know how to behave. So I'm getting some messages here that the airwaves are not clear. So let me see if we can get that sorted out first, because I don't want y'all to miss a beat. So give me 1 second. I appreciate your messages. It might mean that they need to restart a server or something. So let me just send it to Chuck, but he's oftentimes in another studio. So I'm going to send it to Blake as well. Hold on 1 second. All right. So we'll get that sorted out. Do I sound like a robot again? Robot reporting. Let me just see here. Okay. All right. Let's see if we can get somebody on it. I think Dave is on vacation. He's the other tech guy over at the station, but I believe he is on holiday. So let's give them a chance to get it all sorted out here before I start. Because child, honey, chill. Once I start this morning, there will be no stopping. Let's do our morning greetings while we're waiting on them to perhaps restart whatever they're on their end. Right. So what have we got this morning? Let's see which beautiful people are joining me. We have the lovely Vernita. Good morning to you. June is here. Good morning. Happy Tuesday. Miss Olivia is also joining us. Lulu, buenos dias. Felicia, how are you? Hopewell is here. Good morning. Richard joining us. Mr. Richard, is that the Richard from Canada? I think so. Diamond Princess. We have Nasanga from Uganda. Oh, nice. Thank you for joining us. And we have Louis from Detroit. He says, good morning, Sandra and the CMR Nation. End of an era and the beginning of another. Yes, it was quite amazing to watch all the pomps and what's this term that I'm looking for? Pomps and there's something that I'm looking for that's not quite coming to my brain this morning. Wee wee, good morning, Stephen. There were literally people crying, at the funeral for her. And they had her dogs out. Did you guys see the dogs? And one horse that was allowed to actually participate in a way. And they saw her funeral passing by. You know what I was looking for this morning that I couldn't put my hands on immediately? I have a gavel that I keep here. There's certain people that will remember my gavel and they'll chuckle at it. But I can't seem to put my hands on my gavel. I don't know where. It's probably stuck in a drawer somewhere. But I feel like I might need that gavel this morning when I start pounding on it to say, you guys have been found guilty and wanting. Yes, honey, chow. Marshall, good morning. Tuesday Rewind, Spicy Tuesday. Hey. Pageantry, pomps and circumstance. Is that the word I'm looking for? Anyway, it was a lot of... I've got people messaging me trying to help me out here. They're like, I know what you're trying to say, girl. So yes, it was a lot to see. And it was absolutely beautiful. ITV had an amazing, let me see if I can call Chuck. It doesn't look like he's reading his messages. ITV had an amazing series yesterday on the entire search. Like they went through day by day, all of the stuff that has happened since her passing. And it is quite amazing to watch. So yeah. Hey, I think something might need to be restarted on your end. I'm not sure. Just double check it for me. You can hear me okay? Okay. All right. Yeah, poor Chuck. He has a morning show that he does as well. So sometimes he's live at the same time that I am. And then he has to go and on his music breaks, he runs over and sees what's going on. So he'll double check it. Good morning, Siobhan. Hope also says I can hear you clearly on Facebook or on the radio. And Dean is here. Diane, Miss Darlene, good morning, joining us from the UK. Louis is also here. Says Facebook audio is good. Yeah, whatever this is, it's not social media audio. It's something else on the radio. The thing I must say is I've noticed that recently there's been a lag on the Facebook and social media feed. There's a lag between me, like my lips moving in the audio. So I'm not sure exactly what is causing it. I may have to, I'm told that it's fixed now. Okay. All right. Okay. Morning. You sound like you're not on your frequency in the radio, not your voice that's static. You're not on frequency. Oh. Hmm. Okay, pomp and pageantry. I think that's what I was looking for. All right, so somebody said that that issue was just fixed. So we'll go with it. Because we got a lot to talk about this morning, honey Jill. Where do we begin? OMG. Let's talk about what transpires. So good morning to everybody else. Richard Parson is also joining us. Miss Morna is here. Strong Will says that today's topic should be hot and spicy. Let's get started. Yes, let us get started. Good morning to Miss Omiria. Charlene is here. Gina's here. Dean Sinclair is here. Merle Mitchell says buenos dias. And Dean says loud and clear. Let's get it. No time to waste. I actually had to take some notes about this hot mess of a situation this morning because, you know, sometimes I start to talk and, okay, we're loud and clear right now. Had to clean up the feed. Good. Awesome. Good to go. Good morning, radio people, people all the way in radio land. So good to see you. So where do we begin? Well, I guess we start a little bit at the beginning. So on Friday afternoon, people started messaging me saying that William McKeeva Bush was at the airport, headed to, at first people thought he was going to Cuba, and I don't really know why, but somehow I suspect that he probably doesn't travel to Cuba quite as often because Cuba's a different kind of place all the same. Y'all know what I mean? You know, Cuba don't really joke around with certain things. Although some people feel like if they have enough money, anything goes and they can do whatever they want. But despite that, there's certain countries that you don't go in and misbehave because, you know, the government or the people will actually sort you out. So as it turns out, I received a message on Friday at 12:11 p.m. It says, Mac is off to somewhere. I'm at the airport and they're paging him. Long time now. First, it was William Bush and he wasn't responding. I guess he doesn't recognize that name. And now they're saying William McKeeva Bush. So I can hear it now. William Bush paging passenger William Bush. Can you please come to the security area? Additional security. William Bush, please come. Let's put on the robot voice.
William Bush, can you please report to security? Security checkpoint one. William McKeeva Bush, step up to the plate, sir.
That's probably how it went down, right? Step up to the plate, sir. We need you for additional security checks. Your luggage looks a little suspect. So they were paging him. I thought to myself, oh, this is so ironic. How many times have you traveled and actually been subjected to one of those random security checks? It occasionally happens, but it doesn't happen that often. But when it does, everybody knows your business. If anybody didn't know that McKeeva was traveling on Friday, well, they sure knew it at 12:15 when they were paging him in the airport for a while and he wasn't even responding. So he forced them to go from William Bush to William McKeeva Bush. Where are you, sir? We need to go through your luggage and see what's in here. Make sure there's no bombs being taken to Honduras or anything else. Maybe they ignored all the other stuff that might have been in the suitcase. I don't know. Anyway. So everybody then knew that he was traveling and people were like, where's Matt going? Is he going to Cuba? Is he going to Honduras? And I said, well, you know, their favorite stomping ground just happens to be Honduras and Jamaica next. Lord Jesus, please take the bus this morning. So next thing I know, I'm thinking to myself, is this man taking a vacation, a holiday in Honduras? Cause this seems like a very odd time to get away, but you know, given his latest fiasco of wanting to feel up women and bite them on the necks and everything else, who knows? You know, maybe his MO is just run away from it all. I don't know. So, you know, then I hear that, oh, but wait a minute. The minister was spotted with him. And I said, oh, Lord Jesus, here we go. The minister. Nobody didn't even have to tell me which minister, honey, chill. Because at that point, we know, you know, Caymanians and Caribbean people have a saying about batty and bench. Can't be separated. You know your batty, you know what your batty is, right? And the bench. That's how close you are. Mm-hmm. So I then said to myself, Lord Jesus, Why on earth would Minister J.E. Banks be traveling with McKeeva right now? I have to question the common sense, logic, and everything else that seems to occur with certain individuals. So I message the Honorable J.E. Banks. I said, why are you traveling with McKeeva? I mean, it's a logical question. I was curious, and apparently all of you were also curious. Then somebody sent me footage of the two of them. I actually thought, and forgive me for getting this wrong, I actually thought it was at the airport in Cayman. Well, it turns out, I'm just trying to find the footage here. It turns out that it wasn't the airport in Cayman at all. It's just a really quick video snippet. It was actually I guess they take a ferry to La Ceiba from Rotan. Don't ask me, because I'm just not into the whole Honduras scene. But anyway, so they take this ferry and somebody recorded them actually taking the ferry. Now, you know, I keep telling you guys, and I suppose that a lot of people don't quite understand when I say, I am literally the worst person in the world to lie to. I'm the kind of person that if you've done something wrong, you just come and say, damn it, Sandy, all right, here's the real deal. Here's the scoop, you know. Or you don't say anything at all. Sometimes you're better off keeping your big mouth shut. Because when you lie, OMG, I take personal offense to people who lie to me because number one, you clearly think I'm stupid. That's the only reason you would lie to me, because you thought I was born this size and I'm that stupid. Okay. Oh, it's a business trip. Yeah. Okay. I guess the only question is, what kind of business are we talking about? It's a business trip that had long been planned and business must continue, even though Mr. Bush is in the middle of another situation. Uh-huh. Yeah, okay. Okay, Bobo, you got less sense than I thought, but let's go with it. It's a business trip. And despite Mr. Bush's current situation, you are of the opinion that business must go on. That's part of the problem in this country. Why we are where we are. Because politicians seem to think that regardless of what they do, let's just pretend that it's business as usual, and they're going to, you know, continue to do their shenanigans and the people will just ignore it and move on. Well, it's no longer business as usual. And I want to make it very clear here today that if any politician happened to have missed that memo, Jesus help you, because you need to really get with the program. Did y'all not hear us during the election? Did you not see the people protesting and saying enough is enough? I'm trying to find this footage of them in the airport. Lord Jesus, where's the footage? It's like something is inherently wrong with the politicians in this country. I can't put my finger on it, but the closest thing I can come to is stupidity. Y'all have taken the people of this country for fools for far too long. And you didn't get the memo after the last general election that we've had enough and we will not be toyed with anymore. And we have certain standards and expectations, and you just continue with the shenanigans. The one with poor Ralston keeps coming up. That's not the one I'm looking for, iPhone. Oh, Lord. But, you know, that isn't what we are. You know, that's not what we're about anymore. We're going to start to hold, even if you guys can't get it together and have your own code of conduct, we still expect some degree of decency. And the fact that you can't show that and you can't get your act together really says a lot about you, but the people will no longer tolerate your shenanigans. Quite frankly, we're gonna call you out. Oh, here we go. It's only 6 seconds. That's why I couldn't even find it on my poor phone. So anyway, the two of them spotted in Honduras walking together. Lord Jesus. So I'm questioning the whole logic of this. Why on earth would you be traveling with the Speaker of the House? First of all, nobody comprehends. And I don't care what nobody wants to say about this. Nobody understands why McKeeva's there to begin with. The last three trips. And they have somebody else in tow. I don't know. So there's Mr. J with his little overnight bag. and somebody in a red shirt. I don't know who the guy in the red shirt is, but I hear that oftentimes it ends up that some of these North Side friends go with the minister as well, because it's so much business going on in Honduras. The only question I have is, what kind of business? Huh? Y'all think we stupid? Okay, let's go with the agricultural business for now, since y'all want to pretend that that's what it's always about. I would love to see the itinerary. Who was met? What agricultural business was discussed? Right? Who did what, when, where, who? Doing who? Okay, we'll go with it. Agricultural business. What makes the Speaker of the House an agricultural expert? Oh, he's got connections in Honduras. Okay, all right, yeah. He's got connections in Honduras. You know what most people do in this day and age when you have connections? You simply send them on WhatsApp. It happens to me all the time. People are like, oh, I'd like to introduce you. Here's the contact number for this person. Let me send an email and do an introduction. The new Minister of Agriculture of the Cayman Islands will be visiting your country, blah, blah, blah. Roll out the red carpet for him. Extend, you know, what the treatment you give me. You don't have to go, Batty and Bench. You really don't have to go. Especially when we know that the behavior of these men is less than stellar when they visit certain countries like Honduras. Now, on Thursday, I talked about the necessity for the speaker to step down. And I tried to be nice. I tried to be, as someone said, I showed him a lot of grace. They're like, oh my God, Sandy, you showed this man so much grace. And I tried, but you know, some people, you can't show them grace and you cannot be nice to them because they don't learn. Huh? And this is the problem that we're facing this morning. Y'all think that you are bigger than anything else in this world, but I want to remind you that none of you are bigger than the voters who put you in. You pretend to be during the 4 years. And because you've had a stroke of luck and got elected by 26 votes, you still continue to think that there will never be any consequences for your behavior. And the buck is going to have to start stopping. There has got to be consequences for poor political behavior. And this morning, I've got a bag of notes. We're going to break it down for you in case you've been absent for a while. It's absolutely ridiculous what the people of this country have accepted in the name of politics forever, far too long. So I start to question, what's going on here? Why are you with the speaker in Honduras? Oh, business must go on as usual. You know, business don't stop. Oh, yes. Tell that to the victims. Same thing with Ms. Kiman. Tell it to the victims. Nothing stops in this country because someone has been victimized. You get beat up, you get sexually assaulted, you get groped, you get bitten, and it's business as usual for the men running this country. That's disturbing. That is disturbing. Do you guys ever actually sit down and think about the women who were subjected, and men, in the case of Tiffany, who were subjected to your abuse, to your assaults, to your sexual harassment? You think it's business as usual for them? Their lives have been turned upside down because of you. And for you, it's just business as usual. Business must go on. Oh, that's so lovely that you get the option of it being business as usual. Good for you. So the pressure was on. We put up that little video of them in the airport. And next thing I know, within no time, there was this, everybody's messaging me, calling me, Sandy, why aren't you online? What are you doing? And I'm like, Lord have mercy. I was actually trying to get some QuickBooks work done. You know, every once in a while, I do have to do like paperwork and other things, right? Y'all need to see my desk this weekend. What a mess. And it's been like that for a month because I can't get no work done. They said, oh, you need to read Loop. And I said, Jesus, I don't really read Loop. Come on now. What are y'all talking about? They screenshot. And Facebook is such a pain. And tell me how... Loop has on this big to-do about the speaker resigning. So I messaged the minister and I said, the speaker has resigned according to Loop. You've made this big announcement that the speaker has resigned? Yeah, well, you know, I had a talk with him. Really? That's what y'all were talking about in Honduras? I thought it would have been like, oh, look at that mommy. Look at that mamacita over there. Can I get your phone number? Y'all had time to talk something sensible? Okay. If you say so. So this grand announcement comes out with these quotes about how the speaker has decided to step down for country, for love of country. Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you so much, sir. You know, the same thing that we kind of said on Thursday's show, which if you actually did love this country, you probably would have stepped down a long time ago. Your legacy has been soiled beyond repair. Sad. Because it doesn't just impact you. It impacts your children, your grandchildren, your wife, and other people in your life. But, you know, I guess some of them don't have a choice. So, yes, this big story comes out about how he's resigned. And the story gets given exclusively to Loop. Well, I'm not trying to be salty about the whole Loop situation. But what also became very apparent to me, and of course, you know, by then I'm making multiple phone calls like, yay, what is this all about? So then I understand that the minister has a desire to put Mr. Alric in the seat of speaker. Now, I don't know where this brilliant idea came from, but I think Alric is very much aware that that ain't happening. It's not going to happen today. And he's just, quite frankly, not ready. No shade. Y'all know I like Alric, and this has nothing to do with that. It's just that it ain't happening. Let's just leave it at that. So Alric freelances for Loop. And then the question started to be asked, because apparently some of y'all didn't know that. That's just a fact. The young lady who used to write for Loop, she got busy and she does other stuff. I don't know exactly what she does here. But she writes for other publications, but remains in the Cayman Islands. So she's no longer the country manager for Loop. She does something else. I think really she's been writing for other publications, other more illustrious publications, and she has kind of stepped away from Loop. So for whatever reason, you know, Alric has kind of picked up the mantle and has been helping them out on a freelance basis, I guess. I forget her name, by the way. I can't even think of her name right now. Something begins with a D. Daphne, yeah? So she's no longer with Loop. Alric doesn't manage it, but apparently he provides them with content. So anything political that you see in Loop, that the source is normally Alric and the good old boys network, Jay, Chris Saunders, and others giving, you know, Alric these stories. Okay, no problem. We can talk about the good old boys network here in a second. So then I began to wonder, hold on a second here. Loop gets this exclusive story, and I'm a little bit confused. Because if McKeeva has resigned, shouldn't that announcement be coming from the leader of the country, aka the one who signed the initial agreement with him and allowed him to be Speaker of the House to begin with? Why is this announcement coming from Jay Ebanks? And so it didn't take two twos for me to recognize that something is clearly stinking around here. How can it be that you are going to circumvent, jump over, step around, stomp on the premier of the country when he is in London attending the official funeral of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth? Somebody else said to me on Saturday, not for nothing, but they said, Sandy, why is it that every single time the premier goes away on a trip, there is some misbehavior? It's like little children. You know, you decide to go somewhere and your children, that's when they're going to act up because they think that they've got the free rein of the place. It is unbelievable to me that it was business as usual when you were getting on the plane. And then you get to Honduras, and because my video is up and you're complaining about, oh, this is a security risk, and the Honduras police wants to know who took the video at the little airport or you getting on the ferry or wherever the heck you were. All of a sudden, this is a big issue, security issue, and the Honduran police are concerned. The Honduran police don't give two shits about you. They don't care. If anybody met you at the airport, that was your existing security detail. And let me be very, very frank. Those are the same ones who would set you up to be robbed, you fools. Okay? This has nothing to do, oh, they saw it in CMR. Oh, yes, I'm so sure The Honduran police are sitting down watching CMR because they have nothing better to do. They have enough of their own news media outlets that post things that we would never even think about posting. You get shot down in the streets in Honduras and they show everything. They don't care. They have no chill. Sabrina, good morning. Sabrina says Sandy has no chill. No, they have no chill. So once again, your duplicitousness and your lies are really getting under my skin. And I beg you to stop lying. What is so hard about telling the truth? So when I read the story in Loop, you know, before I could write my own story, I need to do some fact checking because I'm like, something seems amiss here. Why is it that you would even release this information like this? And because you are, and I want to be very clear, Alric has never said that he's interested in Speaker of the House or anything of the sort. So I can't speak for Alric, but what I do know is that Minister Jay Ebanks would love for Alric to be Speaker of the House, even if Alric doesn't want it. He would love for him to take up that position. But my question is, you got to be really stupid. Because if this is your guy that you're gunning for to be Speaker of the House, why would you make him write a story about the Speaker of the House resigning? I'm just saying that you have no political experience or knowledge when you pull these kind of amateur stunts. That makes no sense. Because now you have tainted him. Even if he was interested, he could never in a million years now get the position. Wow. Dumb and dumber and dumbest. You have tainted the man. Right? Then you only give him not even half, 10% of this cocky Mamie story, which at the very minimum gives the impression that you have brokered a deal for the Speaker of the House to step down, that you guys have decided. You read the quote. I have considered all my people, my constituency, colleagues, and my family. Well, that would be a first. Enough of this is enough, and the accusations aren't going to stop as long as I hold a post in government. Really, I know the PAC government is a government for the people, and I didn't want to do anything to jeopardize the group in any negative light. Again, no admitting that this is what gets me, right? You cannot be honest, even as you supposedly are agreeing to step aside. You cannot be honest. This isn't about accusations. This is about your actions. And so whilst I went easy on you on Thursday, that is not happening today. We're going to talk about your history of action after action after action that has called your character into disrepute, regardless of how many wonderful things you have done. And those of you sitting back prepared to defend this man, please go sit in the back of the classroom because you don't deserve the grades here today. Pastor Clark, down in that church in Swamp. What's the name of the church? Can y'all remind me? Something Tabernacle, y'all want to fall under the floor church? Please, this man gets up on the podium on Sunday defending the foolishness happening in this country about, oh, the man has had a mishap. But my question is, how many mishaps are you allowed in life before you have to take some accountability? And this is the exact same thing that I was talking to you guys about last week about these churches. They are disgusting. Mishap? So let me just see. In the little time that I've been back to the Cayman Islands, right? The assault of the woman in the casino in Seminole, slapping her, pinching her in the ass, whatever that was about, that was a cultural mishap. Oh, she doesn't understand our culture. Yeah, because your culture is a culture of acceptance, where you can sexually assault women and they're not going to complain. That's not America. That disappeared because some money changed hands. And the complainant was like, all right. How many mishaps are you allowed? First Cayman Bank mishap. We're going to talk about some of the political mishaps this morning. Right? How many times has this man been arrested? There was the misuse of the credit card arrest. Okay, got off because that's a jury trial and y'all just like to let people off. Whether they're guilty or not, doesn't matter. There was a mishap at Coral Beach. There was this last mishap. Everything is a friggin' mishap. At what point do you stop talking about mishaps and you start talking about accountability? And you know, one of the biggest problems here, oh my goodness, sorry. Let me get my lozenge in, child. Oh, one of the biggest problems, thank God for Ricola. One of the biggest problems, folks, in this country is that politically, when you see someone like a McKeeva Bush, he's the epitome of if you are a no good person, right? You look at Mac and say, damn, he's gotten away with everything over the years. Surely I can do the same. And a lot of these Johnny come latelys hang out with him and he's rubbing off on them. And they think, well, Mac has done it. He's been a womanizer forever. He goes to Honduras and does whatever he's want. His wife, not, you know, she don't care. She just hangs on. And y'all think that this type of disgusting, incorrigible behavior can continue. You didn't get the hashtag we are fat up memo. The people of this country are not going to tolerate your foolishness any longer. And we're not our parents' generation that is going to just sit down at home, sipping their tea, talking about it. We're going to get on the airwaves. Okay? And we are going to start to expose you for what you really are. Minister Jay, I'm trying to be nice to you this morning. Jesus, why did you have to bring out this side of me? I didn't want to bring out the messages that I have on any of you. But y'all keep it up. And I'm going to do a real expose on this program. And the Dolly House can mash up for real. Y'all have very short memories. And again, it's because you see other people who've been doing stuff forever and getting away with it. And you think, oh, well, I can do that too. I can have a 25-year career doing whatever I want. No, you can't. We the people are not going to allow it. We are too concerned about increase in fuel, increase in the cost of living. Caymanians afraid that they can never secure a piece of this so-called paradise. Fix some real issues and stop your shenanigans. So why are you over here trying to usurp the power of the premier by making this announcement to take the question marks off of you about what the hell you're doing in Honduras with this man to begin with? Well, it didn't work at all. Because what you then did, and I got to tell you, sometimes I feel very sympathetic for Premier Panton because like he's babysitting a bunch of kindergartners. The man then had to spend his Saturday or Sunday, whatever day it was, preparing a statement to release to say, okay, this isn't anything like what, this isn't what happened. Seriously? Lord Jesus, take the wheel. I mean, what is wrong? Listen, you know, last night I was listening to a little bit of music. On occasion, I do that. And there's a song that I heard in the very beginning of the song. The lyrics made complete sense. Listen to the rest of the song has nothing to do with politics or anything, but listen to how interesting the words of this song are. Just listen to the first little intro bar. You ready? Seems like everybody's got a price. I wonder how they sleep at night. When the sale comes first and the truth comes second, just stop for a minute and smile. Why? Yes. Yes. Y'all heard that? Everybody's got a price. Huh? The truth comes second. Huh. I'm wondering how they sleep at night too. No, sir. Wow. How do y'all sleep at night? I don't know, because you just don't care. It's not going to work out well for you. You'll be a one-hit minister, a one-hit representative of the people. And trust me, in the next election, if I have to go into certain districts, including Northside, and wake y'all up, shake y'all awake, it's going to happen. So then the premier comes out with the following statements. Jesus. First, he says, I've received several media inquiries concerning the statements made by the Speaker of the House and as reported in Loop News yesterday evening. It is disappointing that some members of parliament cannot show restraint. Prior to departing for London, now here's the truth. On Thursday afternoon, the 15th of September, I issued a strongly worded letter to the speaker, suggesting that he resign on or before Friday the 23rd. Whilst a formal written resignation has not been given, I can confirm that I received several messages from Mr. Bush on Friday morning, stating multiple times his intention to resign as speaker. It was my intent to wait until after the official period of national mourning and after Mr. Bush had submitted his written resignation to the Clerk of Parliament to issue any further statement on the matter. Lord Jesus. They can't even be in the UK and mourn the Queen's departure from this earth without some kind of political shenanigans going on. So now you're getting a clearer message of what transpired. Here's the cold hard facts. That letter was shared in the WhatsApp group or whatever the heck it is that they have for all cabinet members. In fact, one of them released it to the Compass before the premier did on Saturday. So the Compass actually had the actual letter first. Now, isn't that interesting? So you mean to tell me that this whole loop article and this announcement on Friday of, the speaker's going to resign. I've spoken to him. I had a talk with Mr. Bush tonight, and I emphasized the fact that the PAC government just can't talk about accountability, but must be seen to be accountable. What the F are you talking about, Jay? Really? Because certainly from this quote, it seems to me, right? In this case, the first step is to relieve Mr. Bush of his duties as speaker. Uh-huh. So you make it sound like nobody else has had this thought and nobody else has vocalized it. And certainly you don't say that, he already had resigned this morning. And the premier, at least in principle, had gotten him to agree to resignation. And that I have seen the letter because Jay is a minister. And this letter was sent in the ministerial group. So Jay Ebanks would have seen this letter to the speaker. That was sent on Thursday the 15th, where the premier says, it is my strong view, a view shared by many, that it is now in the best interest of the people of the Cayman Islands if you were to tender your resignation. He goes on to say, as premier and minister responsible for gender affairs, I will not look the other way or allow this matter to be swept under the rug. The time has come for men to hold each other accountable, especially for inappropriate conduct towards women. Oh my God. Seriously? Yes, the time has come. It came a long time ago, to be quite frank. Really? Stop playing games. You have been exposed with your pants down below the knees and looking mighty stupid right now. The question is why? Why would you even do this? Did you not think the premier was going to step up and say, hold on a second, this is not what happened? Now, the premier is a little bit soft at times, and I think that this is part of the problem. Maybe some people in his own ranks think that they can be the chief because there's never enough Indians, apparently. Everybody wants to be the chief. What would be the point of you trying to put a spin on this narrative as though you are the one who brokered the deal with Mr. Bush when he already had messaged, I'm sure via WhatsApp, the premier from morning and said, yes, I will step aside. I will resign. Now, let me be very, very clear here, folks. He has expressed the intention to resign, but that does not mean he has yet resigned. So he came back on island yesterday. He needs to go to the Clerk of Parliament this morning forthwith and submit his resignation. Because pursuant to section, 65.2b of the Cayman Islands Constitution order, he has to do that in writing. There's a certain format that has to take place before he can resign. The sad thing is the premier has no power to force him to do it. And this is why they are putting pressure on him and saying, you need to resign. There has to be some changes to the standing orders, apparently. And there has to be that code of conduct that we've been waiting on. Y'all better get it done. Because as you can see, you clearly need that code of conduct from last year. The time has passed. We cannot elect people and expect them to be responsible representatives of the people. Obviously, we need a code of conduct. So without that, without the respective changes in standing orders and so on, they have to ask him to resign. And you know what? We the people that keep claiming that we have power, it is time that we elevate that and we demonstrate to them that, oh, okay, that's not just talk. Yes, we do have power. And if that means that we have to protest outside of your house 24/7, keep you up at night and force you to stop drinking with the barang-a-lang-a-lang noise that we can be making outside, where you and nobody else in the neighborhood will get any sleep, then we will do so. Okay? Somebody get the megaphone. You're going to resign. Because now I'm hearing this morning that, oh, he's going to go talk to Mr. Alberga, his esteemed lawyer, and he's going to find a way out of this. And Mr. Alberga is going to say, well, you know, Mac, you don't really have to resign, you know. Yeah, they don't have to force you to resign, you know. There's no legal basis in the Constitution Order 2009 for you to do so. And then he's not going to step. Listen to me. All of you ridiculous people who claim that you love Mr. Bush but can't be honest with this man, y'all need to stop it. Tell the man to step down. The people are done. We've had enough. We've had enough of your games. Jay, you have tainted your own reputation this weekend with this foolish, I don't even know what to call this, stunt. Why would you do this? Now, y'all like to sit back and criticize, what's our little friend name there? The minister, the other minister. What the hell his name is again? Minister Brian. Because he likes to jump the gun a little bit too and make announcements prematurely. But not even to him. He not touching this. Because I suspect he is done. And remember, he's always the one who stood by Mac. And when you had grab your bonky gate, he was like, well, let's see what happens. You know, let's see what the police are going to do. When you had the assault on video, well, let's see what happens. I think the clear message now is even the Minister of Tourism and Transport is finished with this situation. He's like, dude, how many times can I go to bat for somebody? Enough is enough. Right? Honestly, how many times? Huh? That was 2017, the casino incident. In fact, quite ironically, it was one of the first stories that we did. Because remember, we started June 29th. This was July the 19th. We broke the story. McKeeva Bush arrested for inappropriate touching. How many inappropriate touching mishaps are you going to have? Oh, you know, it's obvious that they're not going to leave me alone. Nobody's not going to leave you alone because you can't leave women alone. You can't keep your hands to yourself. You have been a very fortunate man in that nobody has done something to you for touching their wives, their sister, you know, their daughter. It's just enough. Go. Tender your resignation and just be gone. Sit on the back bench and try to do the right thing, because you know what he can try and do right now, right? Because okay, let me move on to the progressives, because Jesus, I don't know who's worse. Here comes the vultures. Let me read some of your comments. Ms. Darlene says, okay, now I see the blind man. Oh my gosh. Now I see, said the blind man. Yes, even the blind man can see. Debbie says, totally agree. Alwick should not be Speaker of the Parliament. There are others who are more qualified past parliamentarians who know their parliamentary procedure, including standing orders. Erskine May? Who's Erskine? Is that what it's called? Erskine May, parliamentary procedures, etc. Let's get real here. Alwick does not know these important issues. Nikki, good morning. So Sandy, it makes sense if you wield a double-edged sword, which many of them do. Forked tongue, devils, pack the government of the people know they're only for themselves, and they even release a statement to that effect. Not sure which statement you were talking about, but definitely send it to me. Thank you, Damien, for reminding us about the first Cayman fiasco. Miss Rhonda says, good show. Have we Caymanians forgotten that McKeeva Bush and his UDP followers went to Honduras to explore and report on agriculture potential, and already reported that it was a good agricultural option to proceed with? Listen, this agriculture thing is a front for something else. I'm just going to say it very plain and clear now. I do not believe this. It doesn't take that many trips. You heard an email? You heard of Zoom meetings? You heard of a friggin' phone call? You don't have to keep going to Honduras for a weekend trip to sort out no foolishness about agriculture. Come on now. Y'all are really looking amateurish. Aliano says there's a standard that should be upheld and protocols that must be followed, but it seems like a free-for-all shit show right about now. No, this is the thing. No concept. I'm going to take these headsets off until y'all start to call in. No concept of protocol whatsoever. No. Because you don't overstep the premier with an announcement that you know he's going to be making to try and make yourself look good. Katsina says Pastor Clark got one of those cabinet statuses that Mac issued that brought thousands of angels and demons to assure us. Oh, okay. Uh-huh. Well, that explains a lot. Tell Pastor Clark that I heard, speaking of demons, that I heard how he got the church sister pregnant. Do we want to talk about you, Pastor Clark? Why are you still up in the pulpit? Anybody, anywhere else in the world, you would have stepped down. That baby for you? Okay. Let's not go there, Pastor. Strong will? Oh, you're just adopting her, are you? Okay. Good morning, Sandy. Pastor Clark did the same thing a couple years back. He's no better. Oh, yes. I'm starting to hear quite a bit about this, Pastor Clark. And let's just say that whatever tabernacle you up in, I'm not impressed. Nikki says, mishaps. The church is not the people attending. The institution that is a church is a shield for the most disgusting degenerates. It sure is. Case in point, slimy sack. Is that sack or slack? Mac and his supporters. Yes, and anytime Pastor Clark has him up in church, I understand he puts him up on the pulpit and be sitting next to him, worshiping him like he's some kind of God. No, sir. Y'all need to shut up, because sometimes you end up exposing yourself when you're trying to defend someone and their behavior that's not defensible. Because then Pastor Clark, people looking at you and they're talking your business. Better mind yourself. Check yourself before you wreck yourself. Good morning, Johan. He says, dear Father God, please remind me to give this woman from CMR a wide berth, and she never knows any of my business because she has no boundaries and will go ham on anybody if the spirit takes her. Hashtag she not easy. Well, it's not even about the spirit taking me. It's about when you continue to lie to the people of the Cayman Islands, at some point we're going to call you to account. We're going to say, not today, Bobo. Stop taking us for fools. Speaking of taking us for fools, Hank says the chickens are coming home to roost for Mac and his enablers, who welcome him with open arms for the sake of power. Take that. Andrea says some of these politicians don't know protocol. Oh, they know protocol. They just don't care about protocol. Right? You don't think that Jay knew better than to issue this announcement bypassing the premier of this country? Like I said, too many chiefs and not enough, not even chiefs, too many wannabe chiefs and not enough Indians. Let me talk a little bit about the people that we are electing to public office. Ms. Gloria, good morning. She says, Sandy, my girl, the tea is hot. And they got you really raved up this morning, but you came prepared, even in your appropriate, even in your appearances, you look really good. Love your blouse and your glasses, hair and lipstick, girl. That's all the outward appearance. Let me talk about this for a bit, because this reminds me, right? Here we are looking at people on the outside, and they are rotting in the inside as elected officials. So as I was thinking about this morning's show, I got to thinking about what makes a good politician. Not a politician, because they shouldn't be politicians. They should be leaders, political leaders, advocates of the people. And what has occurred to me is that we are electing some of the most undesirable people in the world. And nowhere else could they go and get elected but here in the Cayman Islands. And it says something about our standards. We have zero standards, folks. So think about this for a second. We elect people who have no iota of, I've ran a successful business, I have education, I am a professional in my own right, right? That I have proven in some degree, some area of my life, that I can get something right. There are abject failures in their marriages and relationships. Huh? Womanizers, cheaters, fornicators, breaking every, for so-called Christian community, every single, what are we supposed to be, what's the good book that we're supposed to be following? What's it called again? Y'all help me out here now. I might have to really pull out that Bible. Every single commandment. Yes, that's the one I'm looking for. Liars, cheaters, fornicators, adulterers, the works. We put people in power who don't even have the desire to learn their jobs. They jump up with this snake tongue and can say one or two things to maybe 75% of you that sounds good. And boy, y'all are easily impressed. I'm always in shock and awe when people say to me, boy, you heard his contribution? Mm-hmm. Boy, he sound good, you know? Yeah, boy, he for the people, he stand up. And I'm sitting there going, oh, Jesus, help me. I just be like, Sandy, just keep your mouth shut, because the people not ready for the God's truth. Y'all are so easily impressed. Oh yeah, they speak so well. According to who? From my high school debate days, those high schoolers would run circles around most of your politicians. They can't even speak. And yet, we are electing them to public office, paying them an extremely decent salary, and the minimum stuff that they should be doing, they can do. And it is no wonder that your business can never be taken care of. And you wonder why. You know why? Because the complex issues that the world are facing take someone who has some knowledge and understanding of world affairs, of regional affairs, of local affairs, someone who is solution-driven, who can actually get something done. And that is not what we're elected into public office. Good morning, caller.
Good morning, Sandy. How are you?
Oh, Lord, you're coming in loud and clear. Let me turn you down a little bit. I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good. This morning just seems like deja vu.
Oh, Lord it's Jesus. Yes.
We are waking up in a constant nightmare.
Yeah, right?
It's like, and you know what? Mm. As a child, I remember in primary school, you were given an exercise
mm-hmm.
to cut out all of these MLAs and stick them in your book.
Mm.
And you had to list the district that they were from.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in my 40s.
Mm.
And I remember cutting out McKeeva Bush.
Mm-mm.
And you know, yes, he's popular with the people.
Mm.
But is he good with the country, for the country?
Mm-hmm.
And we tend to lose sight as to what people are there for. Yes, they're community workers. you know, they'll come and help you with your roof. Mm-hmm. But are they good for the country?
Amen.
And we tend to elect these individuals mm-hmm. as ministers mm-hmm. to represent us in the country.
Yes.
Where all this time, all they're good at is representing our farmhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And we can't make that. And I'm serious about this because we are the people to blame. We can't blame them and putting them in power.
Absolutely.
We have to place the blame on ourselves. What does that say about us as the community, as voters? We need to understand the difference between those that are community leaders and those that are leaders for the country. And I make a good example. Imagine if we had Mr. McKeeva, I'm just giving you an example,
mm-hmm.
as a premier, and in the situation right now with Her Majesty's funeral, can you imagine the shame of the Cayman Islands having someone of that nature going to represent us?
Lord
and
Jesus.
This is where we have to think about country before anything else. If you go to the polls, you have to think about, is that person representing my country? And I feel that we lack patronism towards our country.
Mm-hmm.
And you keep saying, oh, well, yeah, you're a British colony, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Country.
Mm-hmm.
Country when it comes to those who are making immigration policy.
Mm-hmm.
Country when you're interviewing an individual for the job. Country when mm-hmm. you're representing us overseas. Country when you're going to even represent whatever you need to do, either Miss Cayman or the Olympics, country.
Yes, child.
And I have to make that clear because if those voters thought about country,
yes,
McKeeva Bush would have been out long time
yes,
ago.
Yes, yes. But they're thinking about
but
the sulfur they're getting.
No. And I mean, again, he might be a good community person. He might know your grandmother, your great-grandmother.
Mm.
He might be able to know your cousin. He might know everything about your life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's awesome. And I'm not shooting him down for that. What I'm saying is he's a shame. He brings shame to a country with this behavior. In this world age where we have to protect rights of women, including men, and those type of behaviors is unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have another individual who is probably community leader, Minister J.E. Banks, and then making comments to mm-hmm. put shame in country. How are you going to come out on top of the premier? Are you mad? Have you lost yourself
mm-hmm.
in where you are? And then what? We're going to go to Honduras? Really?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of escape thing are you doing? What? Let's keep it on the down low, Mickey. I think you need to leave off island, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what the conversation was about
mm-hmm.
agriculture. Give
mm-hmm.
me a break.
Mm-hmm.
Country. Is what I am asking people. And anytime all of those ministers go up there and they make a fool of themselves, they're not just making a fool of themselves. They are shaming us
mm-hmm.
as a country.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much all I have to say this morning.
I appreciate it, my dear. Thank you so much.
Okay.
All right. So I agree 1,000% with the caller. We are to blame, without a doubt. We're the ones who are electing them to public office. So they can't blame themselves because they don't have enough votes to vote for themselves. I'm sure if they could, they would. We have no concept of what political leadership is about. We elect people who have no desire to learn and improve upon themselves. They lack maturity. My apologies. They are the most immature bunch, and I tell you, it's nothing unique to the PAC government. It is something that has run rampant in this country for a very long time, and I'm going to give y'all some examples of it here shortly. Good morning, caller. Welcome to the program.
Good morning, Sandra.
Oh, my goodness. Good morning.
Aren't we idiots or what?
Boy, we must be.
Yes,
as Caymanians would say, real dodo brains. Yes, we have to acknowledge it.
And about J.E. Banks, according to gossip here in West Bay, and I live in West Bay, I'm hearing that is his regular company every night on 2-3 of them is down McKeeva's house every night. Now, it's just gossip, but you know these things happen. Where there is smoke, there is fire, right? But I can tell J.E. Banks, I went to school with that so-called leader that we so pushing up there, thinking that he's God. And I can tell the minister, he's dealing with fire. McKeeva's a devil. He's a bully. He's a real bully. He's a disgrace to Cayman. And Mr. J should not have went ahead of who he think he is. Huh? The second McKeeva?
Well, this
but
is the problem.
So many idiots in West Bay. That's why half of them do not work anymore. People that I used to work with do not work anymore because they get nothing but handouts. Mm-hmm. Who is the money for? Mm-hmm. The money is for us, the people that work so hard and hoping that when we get older, that we'll have something to live off. Yet we're paying people to shame us all the time, every 4 years. Mm. McKeeva should have been out of office long time. And if the premier can do it, thank you, premier. And if he don't do it, we should make a big protest.
He can't remove him. And let me be very clear about this. He can't remove him from office. He can't even remove him from Speaker of the House. He can ask him to resign from Speaker. To remove him from office, the people of West Bay must do their job.
Yes.
And they are 26 of you who made the difference in the last election, and I mean more than 26 voted, you are now responsible for this hot mess. Take some accountability.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. But as I always said to you, we could go on for the whole day. In fact, I wish you had your show on for the whole day. I wouldn't get nothing done, but it is worth it.
And neither would I. I appreciate the sentiment. Thank you, my dear.
Okay. Good morning.
Okay.
And
yes,
thank
ma'am.
You very much.
Good morning. Good morning, Cayman. Rise and shine. We are waking up to some truth telling this morning. So it's a sad indictment on all of us that we have people who are supposed to be in a leadership position that should not even be able to gain the respect of your house hamster, truth be known. Leadership, folks, involves a lot of skills and talent that they do not have. Listen to this. It has been said that to be an effective leader is someone who knows when to lead, when to follow, and when to get out of the way. Because just because you're a leader doesn't always mean that you lead in the traditional sense. Sometimes you follow. You have to listen. That phrase comes from American revolutionary Thomas Paine. Leaders don't just give orders. It's about a shared vision for the future of the Cayman Islands. Coming up with a viable strategic plan for how we're going to deal with all of the issues that we're facing. How we're going to negotiate a way forward. Some things, quite frankly, are out of our control. And leadership means coming to the people and being honest about what you can do and what you cannot do. Let me talk about the premier for a second. He's in the UK at the moment. I don't know, what's the time difference? It'd be afternoon there, right? Sometimes your leadership style is dictated by who you have around you. So you have to adjust your style based on the people that you have in your group. And there are times that I actually feel sorry for the premier. There have been rumors from day one that this government isn't going to last the 4 years. There's going to be a coup. There's going to be a this. There's going to be a that. As I reflected on those points, it made me recognize that Cayman is politically immature. And there is nothing new about a coup. And so we have to have a history lesson this morning. What do we say about history? You are destined to repeat it if you have not learned a lesson from it. And so when I heard about the vultures, AKA the progressives, posting stuff on Thursday, let's go to their page, honey chow, because, oh, they are, oh, so special, Facebook. So right away, when they see Mac at it again, it's like, here we go. They start to post on their page. Let me show you what they put up. And somebody said to me, oh, we need the progressives back. I said, you must be crazy. Y'all must really be crazy. We need the progressives back. Oh, their leader did a message 20 hours ago. Talking about, oh, they're celebrating 20 years. Well, I'm going to talk about Mr. McTaggart here in a minute. Because he wasn't with the progressives 20 years ago when it all started. I was there. I was a founding member of the progressives. And it started with the best of intentions. Now look at where they're at. They're a disgrace. As all political parties in this country have become. An utter disgrace, and I'm going to tell you why here in a second. Good morning, caller, and welcome to the program. Hello? Hi. Caller? I can hear a little bit of noise, but I can't hear your voice. Are you there? Hello, caller. Are you there? All right, let's give you a minute to get it sorted out, honey chow. We don't have a minute to waste this morning. So he's doing a whole message about, oh, the progressives are celebrating 20 years, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, okay. On Thursday, their response to this situation was immediately to put up a series of posts. Did y'all see it? Let me share it with you in case you missed it. This is part of now the vulture mentality and the playing of games. Political parties are a way for people with a shared vision on their community to come together. After all, teamwork makes the dream work. Oh, yes. So, you know, they have made some points, and I'm not saying that they're 100% wrong. I want y'all to be very clear that, you know, they're more put together than the PAC government. Well, they're more put together because they have had a structure in place for what they say now is 20 years, where you don't question the leader of their of the pack. And if you do, you certainly don't do so in a public way. But I want to actually give the people some real examples of why that is not really, on the face of it, that is said, but that's not really what's happening behind closed doors either. Good morning, caller.
Good morning, Ms. Sandra, and good morning to everybody.
How are you?
Yes, I'm trying to make the best of it. I just wanted to talk about the tributes for the Queen that was done yesterday and another one going to be done today, our late Queen.
All right. We're talking politics this morning, so make the comments about the Queen as quick as you possibly can. Unfortunately, she's dead and can't help us anymore. We got to help ourselves now.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Understood. Okay. There's a tribute on the maritime scene from the fourth biggest gas carrier in the world coming from India, going to Louisiana, passing off of South Sound in about 2 hours' time, south of Grand Cayman. Mm-hmm. And it will be given a 7 long blast to honor our late queen. Mm-hmm. Each blast of the horn will signify 10 years of reign for our late queen. Mm-hmm. So 7 long blasts will be done by the Vivid Americas LNG, which is a Greek-owned natural gas tanker, going to Louisiana to load gas to go back to India. Mm-hmm. So all the best and a happy day to everybody.
All right. Very good. Thank you so much.
I have limited time.
Yes, appreciate it. Good. Thank you. Sir.
Sure. Bye-bye.
All right, little update there from Kim and Brack, but we're not too worried about the queen this morning. She's laying in eternal peace. The rest of us can't have no peace with these politicians that we've elected to public office. So the vultures, aka the progressives, are on it. They've been making phone calls over the weekend, having secret meetings, and trying to tear this government apart. Nobody should be surprised by this. This is nothing that we're not expecting from them. Because the second the election results came in, was it Joey that said, oh, the progressives have lost the government but not lost the election? Say what? They were out there trying to broker all sorts of deals to get back in power because they are a bunch of power-hungry individuals who will sell you down the river. So to my dear friend from South Sound who said, oh, maybe we need the progressives back. Oh, hell to the no. We do not. I'm going to remind you of the type of people the progressives are. Back it up now. Let's just look at the McKeeva Bush situation alone. What have we recognized last year, February the 22nd of 2020. I'm going to rapidly go through these events. CMR broke the story of the assault at Coral Beach. Within half an hour of it happening, we were getting phone calls. We broke that story on February 22nd of 2020. February the 25th, Ezard Miller calls for the speaker's resignation. February the 26th, he takes this mysterious leave of absence that is not even in the Constitution anywhere. So this so-called progressive government, which y'all claim that you want to keep in or you want to put back in, did not even follow the Constitution of this country. They allowed Mr. Mack to sidestep any accountability by taking a leave of absence. Ezard Miller pointed out there's no legal remit for this. They make it up as they go along. February the 27th, Ezard Miller again calls the speaker's leave of absence unconstitutional. He says, show me where in the Constitution this is permitted. The progressives don't appreciate, don't care about your Constitution. That's exactly what they were saying. March the 6th, Wayne Panton and Osborne Bodden resign because the progressives refuse to take a position on this. The current leader of government business, Roy McTaggart, it took him forever to issue one half-assed statement. Like, oh yeah, we don't really support violence against women. I don't even know if Alden ever said anything. All the women in this group had zero, zilch, nada to say. You think that I could be part of a party or any group of people and know that someone assaulted a woman and I don't care what the alleged circumstances are and the spin that they're now trying to put on it? It was a vicious assault. I was in court, one of the few people that even bothered to go to court. None of these politicians went to court. They don't care. That's why. I heard the witness statements. Mr. Bush pled guilty to the facts as laid out by the prosecution. Hear me clearly. And the facts included no excuses. His fancy lawyer, Ms. Salberger, tried at the last minute to say, well, you know, my client says as it relates to count number 3, blah, blah, blah. And the judge said, excuse me, sir. And that's one time that little guy, Simon, what's his name? The little prosecution guy there, little short man that they had to get rid of from the DPP's office. That was one time he actually stood up and did the right thing because he said, no, Your Honor, excuse me. He is either going to admit in full to the prosecution's version of events. We have all these eyewitness statements. Or if he is going to dispute it, then we're going to have what's called a Newton hearing where we bring the witnesses in to testify before the court. And then the court can decide if you're going to believe Mr. McKeeva Bush or you're going to believe all these other witnesses. That's the truth. And you know what, then his lawyer said, well, Your Honor, after consulting with my client, yes, we're going to go ahead and just accept the prosecution's case. And as the judge said, it was a vicious, unprovoked attack. That is what he pled guilty to. So all of you fools who saw the video in isolation without any other knowledge, witness statements, or anything else, who want to now believe that that woman attacked him, you have no sense whatsoever. That's not what happened. Stop giving people excuses for bad behavior. You are the reason why they are the way that they are. You're the reason why they continue to remain in power, because you empower them, you enable them, and it has to stop. So March the 6th, Wayne and Ozzie resign. Then we have protests. Remember the protests? Correct me if I'm wrong, but as I recall, the only MP that was out there, and he wasn't even an MP at the time, was Wayne Panton, protesting alongside women and other men who were like, this cannot continue. Kathy Wilkes came out for a short period of time, but she worked for government at the time, so I don't think she could say much. Because they were like, oh, you can't be out there. You know how government is, honey, chill, when you're a civil servant. April the 24th, he was charged with 4 counts of assaulting the bar manager. Early July, he pleads not guilty. This is despite issuing a half-ass apology where he's like, oh, I was drunk. I don't really remember, but I know something happened, so I'm sorry. Mid-August, the trial date was set. Then by early December, he pleads guilty. December 23rd, again, Ezra Miller calls for him to resign, and Alden refuses. Then by January, a month later, the 28th, the opposition leader, Mr. Arden McLean, files a motion to remove Bush as Speaker of the House. And you guys know what happened to that. He was going to do a vote of no confidence on January the 28th. Alden went and spoke to the governor and said, call an early election. Instead of holding McKeeva Bush accountable, as they should have, they decided to call an early election instead. And if you have any doubts about where they stood on this, I want to remind you, the people, in Alden's own words. Here we go.
And also, just to the Premier and the Minister, seeing as I will probably won't get another opportunity, this morning the Speaker was convicted and he was handed a 60-day suspended sentence, among other things. Do you have any plans in Parliament to present a vote of no confidence in the Speaker, or are you content to let him sit in his position?
Well, this is news to me. I haven't been apprised of that. Obviously, the government will have to take time to consider the matter, but what I will say about that is that there may or may not be another meeting of the House before the House is dissolved in March. I am not sure that the country would be well served now by my taking action which precipitates the collapse of the government and the holding of early elections. So we have to bear that in mind.
Thank you.
No, sir. Let me break it down again. If I
and
was
also just to the Premier and the Minister, seeing as I will probably won't get another opportunity this morning.
I'm going to pull this in a different way where I can mute it and pause it and that sort of thing. One second here. If I was a body language expert, my dear child, and I was dissecting this foolishness, trust me, even as an amateur viewer here, there is so much about this that is problematic. First of all, the Premier claims that he did not know that morning that, where did I put this now? This is in this folder. Hold on one second. He claims now that he didn't know, hear this story, that he did not know about the verdict that morning. What? You are at the time, the Premier of the Cayman Islands, and the Speaker of the House was found guilty and sentenced, and you claim that you don't know that information? because this press conference, this was a press conference with the medical people there. I forget what they're called now. But this press conference happened late in the afternoon. And the premier claimed that he didn't know that Mr. Bush was sentenced, a custodial sentence that was suspended. That is a bold-faced lie. Look at the body language.
To the premier and the minister, among other things, to present a vote to let him sit in.
Well, this is news to me. I haven't been apprised of that. Obviously, the government will have to take time.
Look at the body language. Huh? You see this symbol here? This is someone who is closing themselves off to you. So even his, early indications to Wendy is like, okay, you need to back off. I'm not receptive to this question. I'm not open to this question. Y'all gonna learn a little something here today.
I have to consider the matter, but what I will say about...
When you are going to tell a lie, your body has a way of giving it away. You know that a lot of people inadvertently cover their mouths when they are lying? Go watch somebody expert, language experts. And you will see what I'm talking about. Look at the first thing he does. What I would say is, here comes the lie. Start scratching the outside of his lip, touching his lip, because the lips are going to lie to you right now. Here's the lie.
That is that.
Look, did y'all see that? Did y'all see how many times he actually had to, play with that lip?
About that is that.
Those micro movements say a lot. The man is lying.
There may or may not be another meeting of the House before the House is.
And he goes on to talk foolishness about, he doesn't want to precipitate anything that would call an early election. You still end up calling an early election because you couldn't stand by the right thing with McKeeva Bush. Now this weekend, you have the audacity to be calling people, talking about, we can pull this government apart and we can put back in a progressive-led government. Y'all not seen no protesting yet, Alden, go back to the farm. You need to go sit down. The people of this country need to know the truth. Y'all want to know the truth? Here you know. Let me tell you something. This government is already preparing. Not the PAC government. I'm talking about the opposition, the progressives. They've already got people lined up for the next election, and not very many of them are worthy. Richie Barton, I hear through the grapevine that you're going to be running on the progressives ticket. Tell me, don't go so. Then I thought to myself, that would certainly explain your last few letters to the editor. You calling out the road signs. Kenneth Bryan is politicking. He's still campaigning throughout the election with these road signs. It's so ironic because the PAC government is the one who put you in as chairperson on this immigration board to give you a little bit of exposure. But you're actually working with the progressive government to run in the next election? Tell me it's not true now. Tell me I'm wrong. Because y'all know I hears a lot. I'm hearing what's going on. I'm hearing the alliances that are already being formed ahead of the next election. Y'all need to stop it now. Those type of arrangements, that's not someone who has the best interests of the country at heart. To his credit, he might be more intelligent and well put together than some others, but that isn't everything. That's only part of the equation. That's part of the formula of what makes a good leader. Y'all want the progressives back in power? Well, let's look at their current leader. Because he, my friend, is only a mouthpiece for Alden McLaughlin. Alden is the puppet master. And Mr. McTaggart, with all due respect, you are the proverbial puppet. So much so that you all have forgotten that Roy McTaggart never believed in political parties when it did not suit him. Now he's on his platform talking about, the progressives are turning 20 and political parties are awesome and they work and support me and having another 20 years of foolishness. Well, this is what the man said at one point. Listen carefully.
Independent Georgetown candidate Roy McTaggart insists he is not the leader of any political group. Good evening. I'm Mona Lisa Tatum. Well, Mr. McTaggart says he is looking for endorsement from advocacy group Coalition for Cayman. He will not pledge allegiance to any one leader but the country. Cayman 27's Tammy Suleiman has this interview.
I don't look at myself as being emerging as a leader.
Former KPMG chair and chartered public accountant Roy McTaggart says he is frustrated with what he calls divisiveness in the Legislative Assembly.
Do you think, though, that the problem is not necessarily the party system, but perhaps the parties that we have right now? Would you say that that's where the disillusionment lies?
Well, I prefer to categorize it as the party system, because it forces, I think, people and politicians into a certain mindset and into a certain way or positions that might not necessarily be in the best interest of the country.
As an independent candidate, he says he is seeking endorsement from political advocacy group Coalition for Cayman. Here at the group's first public meeting, it told the country it is adamantly against political parties.
There are those who are saying if it smells like a rose, it must be a rose. How do you argue that CFC is not a party?
I don't see that at all. They are looking to endorse candidates. They're not looking to dictate to them where they go and what positions they should take.
But Mr. McTaggart acknowledges that Cayman's 2009 constitution favors the party system, not making it so easy for independents in the Legislative Assembly.
But it does not preclude in a group of independents.
With that end in mind, Mr. McTaggart says he wants to use his skills and expertise to curb Cayman's spending problem and drop the stagnant unemployment rate. He knows it will take like-minded people to effect that change within the Legislative Assembly. Tammy Suleiman, Cayman 27. Mr. McTaggart says he will work with fellow Georgetown independent candidate Winston Connolly. As for any others who may join them, he says we'll have to wait and see.
Right. So this was a man who said fundamentally he does not agree with party politics. When asked if party politics is really the issue, he said yes. That is the issue. And now look at him, the leader of the progressives, of a party. So when they talk to you about, well, you know, people, independents who tried to come together as a loose group of people with no shared vision and blah, 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 that not gonna work. That's strange, because you yourself was actually saying that's exactly what you were gonna do when you were part of C4C. So are we to believe the man from then? Are we believing the man now who's actually in the party and has the benefits of the party structure to try and push your own agenda and your own initiatives? Which truth are we going to believe? I'm just curious. Which is it? These are the games that politicians are playing. And we, the people, are on the receiving end of it all. You know, there's been a couple really sage and wise people that have said certain things throughout their lifetime. And one of those people who had a lot of really interesting things to say was Bob Marley. He said a lot about politics. Here's a couple snippets of things that Bob Marley said that y'all might want to think about this morning.
Politics divide and rule. Politics don't show people God. Politics tell you that somebody can do something fair. You know, what we know is God will do everything. So the best man to deal with is God. When you deal with God, you don't deal with politics, because politics divide and rule.
Well, I'm going to agree with the last part. Politics can divide if we let it. If we let these politicians hoodwink us, it can divide us, absolutely. They stand up on a pedestal and say, oh, you the people have the power. And yet at every opportunity possible, they're usurping our power. They're showing us, as Alden did. Remember when Alden built that school? What did he say? An act of God. It's going to take God himself to stop me. That is the audacity of a narcissist who just happens to also be a politician. Nobody can stop him but God. Really? And there's more like him that's in there that have this belief that we, the people, can't stop them. There's nothing that we can do. Let's talk about the stability of politics in the Cayman Islands. For the record, y'all can correct me if I'm wrong, but there's been two coups in this country politically. One happened in 2001, and that was led by McKeeva Bush himself. Pay attention now. Class is in session. Every time there's been some political disruption in this country in recent history, McKeeva Bush is at the center of it. He aided vote of no confidence, Kurt Tibbetts, in 2001. That led to the formation of the UDP and the Progressives in 2003. Why? As well as the status grants, all given away, or birthright. Why? Oh, Kurt Tibbetts is sitting in the bar room drinking. Well, thank God that's all Kurt Tibbetts was doing. He wasn't being arrested for slapping, pinching, groping somebody in Seminole County. He wasn't being arrested, convicted, and sentenced to vicious assault on a woman at Coral Beach. He wasn't being investigated again for another touching, unwanted touching, and groping and biting of multiple women at an international conference held in the Cayman Islands. He wasn't arrested, charged, and taken to court over misuse of credit card. And still, McKeeva Bush managed to remove him in 2001. May the 13th of 2011, right? So when these politicians want to tell you about, oh, well, this government, we don't know how stable they're going to be. The truth of the matter is politics in Cayman has never been about stability. It's one of the reasons why anybody with a little bit of sense is like, oh, honey child, we can't leave the UK right now. Because it's going to be a free-for-all. These guys will do whatever they want. May the 13th, 2011. Let me show you all some clips here on this. This was Alden McLaughlin saying that we need to, I'm going to come back to this one, that we need to remove the speaker. Oh, that's 2012. Hold on. There's been so many of them, I can't even keep up. All right. I think this is the one from 2011. See what it says here? McLaughlin said he expected that both Ardern, McLean, and Miller will form part of the next government alongside the PPM after that general upcoming election. So this is when Ardern McLean actually resigned from the PPM. And of course, the truth was not told then about why Ardern resigned. He resigned, and I was part of the party, and I was there, so I'm telling you what actually happened. He resigned because his fellow party person, aka Alden McLaughlin, wanted to become the next leader of the party after Kurt Tibbetts was stepping down, and he did not want to do it in the way that it was supposed to have been done, the proper voting method. He was going behind Ardern's back, currying the votes and calculating the votes. Oh, you must vote for me. This is how it's going to go down. Pre-arranging the outcome of the election. Yes, that is what happened, and that is why Ardern stepped down. So the difference between this government, because we hear a lot of their internal issues, is that in the Progressive Party, they just keep it hush hush. But that does not mean it's not happening. Or it didn't happen. That is why Ardern resigned. Right? Were y'all calling on a coup then? Were y'all saying, oh, that government's going to be falling apart? No. Because you were not the wiser. Lack of information, you'll perish because of lack of knowledge. This speaks of the 2001 coup that happened in 2011 now, when they were talking about they might bring another one against McKeeva. November 2001 marks the last time such a motion was brought against the ruling government. The 2001 motion helped foster the formation of today's political parties, the United Democratic Party and the People's Progressive Movement. Just reminding you all of the facts, folks. This is how it went down. Right? And that motion brought by MLA Ralston Anglin and Lyndon Martin brought about the dissolution of what was essentially a coalition government led by then leader of government business, Kurt Tibbetts. So this concept of a coalition government, even basically just independents getting together and working it out, is something that has always happened. Hear what McLaughlin says. McLaughlin has pointed out that Mr. Anglin, who's now a government minister, has railed against him bringing the lack of confidence motion, even though Mr. Anglin did the same thing a decade ago. Same bag of tricks. However, Mr. McLaughlin also pointed out that a new constitution has changed the rules since then, and that it is now harder for votes of lack of confidence to succeed in either removing the leader of government or in calling for new elections. So legislatively, constitutionally, it's not as easy to remove people. Y'all voted for the constitution, so you should know what you voted for. In the 2009 constitution, the responsibility for ministers shifts to the premier. And this is why, for example, just the other day, the premier could sanction Bernie Bush. Okay? But he doesn't have that option with the other members of parliament. The governor is required to revoke a premier's appointment only if a motion of the LA declares a lack of confidence in the government and gets support from at least 2/3 of the elected members. So at that time, 2/3 was 10 out of 15. Now we got up to 19, so y'all do the math. It is not possible for the House to revoke the appointment of individual ministers. This is what Mr. McLaughlin said at the time. He said at that time, the opposition didn't have the votes for lack of confidence motion to succeed, because basically they would need people from the government side as well. And of course, Mr. Anglin said, when I moved the motion of no confidence in 2001, I made sure that I had the votes. I made sure that I went to the governor to ensure that I had a government in place to make sure the country was stable. Well, they all want to claim that they're stable. Questionable at best. So in this instance, in 2011, the same UDP members, they're like shapeshifters, always changing. They now at that time said that they would not support a lack of confidence motion. Well, as luck or whatever would have it, in 2012, my apologies, they ended up having to remove McKeeva Bush in any event when he was charged, arrested and charged. And that is how Juliana O'Connor Conley became the first female premier of the Cayman Islands, because his own party had to remove him in December of 2012. Then they turned around and formed a new party, the People's National Alliance. Remember them? They were short-lived. Only God knows what happened there. So this was from 2012, about the resignation of Arden McLean from the party. Pure lies about this is something Arden had been wrestling with for some time, about his political fortunes lay outside the pretty flowery words meaning nothing, bunch of lies. Arden resigned because of the underhanded tactics of Alden McLaughlin in the election of who would be the next leader of the party. They were going to ensure at all costs that it wasn't going to be Arden, that was for sure. In 2016, they were talking about the possibility of calling an early election. Imagine that. I'm reminding you of all of these things as a point to say, listen, folks, do not forget what these politicians have done in the past and what has transpired. They are vultures, wolves in sheep's clothing, and nothing has changed. See what they said at the time? This is a CNS article. April the 20th of 2016. Talk about the government having a wafer-thin majority. Does that sound familiar? Huh? Means that the people could be voting in a general election sooner than the May election? The government couldn't even command a majority in parliament at the time, the legislative assembly, right? Premier Alden McLaughlin has not ruled out calling an early election. This was 2016. This sounds like deja vu. He indicated that a poll in November, when he was already facing challenges in April, was probably not going to help. Wow. All familiar, folks. We've been here before. We've been down this road before. Nothing new. Nothing new. They can't even get the people's business done because of this foolishness. And here we are on the hamster wheel. Booker T. Washington says a lie doesn't become truth, wrong doesn't become right, and evil doesn't become good just because it's accepted by the majority. This is another brilliant quote. Funny thing about getting older, your eyesight starts getting weaker, but your ability to see through people's BS gets much better. And there's a lot of it going around. So the question remains, will Mr. Bush be doing the right thing today or not? Will he actually tender his resignation? That remains to be seen. Tracy says a politician with a criminal record? Yes. Damien says it's called short-term memory. That's why some of them get voted back in. It's not even short-term memory. People just don't care is the only conclusion that I can come to. Perla says, know your people first before you decide on who you will vote in the next election. Yes, I think we need to vet them a little bit better. We need to do more. We're just not stepping up to the plate, and it's unfortunate. And so when they start to act up and they start to show their true colors, I suppose none of us should really be entirely surprised. Ms. Darlene says, the truth be told, Sandy, yes, progressives should have sacked him back in the day. The PAC was worse by having the knowledge of what he did and who he was and brought him in to make up the numbers. Well, you can certainly see it different ways. Unfortunately, although they had no choice but to do so, at least they put something in place. Do not think for 1 minute, Ms. Darlene, that the progressives would not have done the same had they been given the opportunity. This is politics. In order for them to capture the government, if the last man standing was McKeeva Bush, just like they had done before with the unity government and all the stuff he had done prior to that, they would have turned the blind eye and done the exact same thing. As long as the people of West Bay continue to put Mr. Bush in, he could always be the last man standing that helps to form a government. And that is the dangers of keeping him in as an elected member. Katsina says, no more progressives, no more Mac, Bush, no more. Jay, we have enough land in East End and North Side. We can develop into farm land, running all over the place nonsense. It's just so crazy that As long as Cayman has been around, as long as Honduras has been there, only now we can forge these so-called relationships that require you to travel all over the place. The last 3-4 months, every time you and Mac going as batty and bench to these places. And people capturing video footage of stuff that's going down. You must have want that to come up on the screen next. Good morning, Eden. Eden says, thanks for laying it all out. For those who forgot, brighter days soon come, but there are dark days ahead until we get there. Who will unify our people? Perla says something was news to her. That's when Alden was saying it was news to him. Yeah, chill. What a farce. Daphne says, so true, body language cannot lie. You just need to look for the signs, honey, chill. Perla says, yep, body language not lying. Act accordingly. But he doesn't think. He wasn't thinking or acting. He just got caught red-handed. Miss Charlene says, not too many people wear body language, much less the skilled mindset to read it. What a mess. What a mess. No, sir. Magdalene says, wow, that's not good if it's true about Mr. Barton. Well, that's what the streets are talking, that he is in bed with the progressives and they're going to put him up as candidate in the next election. Already brokering deals. And there are other names that are being floated around as well as supposed candidates. Who's going to run against who? Kathy, apparently you got somebody there in West Bay that they're going to be supporting, another female that's coming after you as well. I mean, this is what political parties do. You know, I'm just telling you the facts as they are. And the thing about it is, what I don't like is if you are in talks with the progressives, right? Just come out and say, yeah, I'm going to run in the progressive ticket in the next election so that every time you write something, you submit something, we know the truth. We know the angle in which, you know, we're like, yeah, okay. We see what's going on here. Don't try to fool the people, because we're not so easily fooled anymore. Well, most of us. What a mess. I was reading something last night about, let me see if I can find it now. And then I want to touch on the Miss Cayman fiasco, because I have seen your comments and I'm not ignoring them, but I'm going to try to deal with that separate. So Charlene says, Sandra, you're on target with facts and truth. I'm so grateful for you. Thank you. You're most welcome. Yornel says, nothing has changed, but we need change for the better. It's the more an honorable thing to do for him to resign. He's crossed the line. Well, the question is, how many times do you get to cross the line before enough is enough? And I'm telling you, the people of the Cayman Islands have got to make demands on these politicians. If we sit back silently and do nothing, then nothing will happen as usual. Despite that, I wish to thank the premier for his strongly worded letter, which was sent last week, despite the fact that he was trying to pack and focus on the all the stuff that was going on around the death of the late queen. I'm going to share a link with you guys, because I think you need to read this. As a man thinketh. James Allen reveals how our thoughts determine reality. Whether or not we're conscious of it, our underlying beliefs shape our character, our health and appearance, our circumstances, and our destinies. Right? Huh. Very, very interesting. Listen to some snippets from this, and I'll share the link with you guys so you can read it in more detail. A man's mind may be likened to a garden, which may be intelligently cultivated or allowed to run wild. But whether cultivated or neglected, it must and will bring forth. If no useful seeds are put into it, then an abundance of useless weed seeds will fall therein and will continue to produce their kind. Just as a gardener cultivates his plot, keeping it free from weeds and growing the flowers and fruits which he requires, so may a man tend the garden of his mind, weeding out all of the wrong, useless, and impure thoughts and cultivating towards perfection the flowers and fruits of right, useful, and pure thoughts. By pursuing this process, a man sooner or later discovers that he is the master gardener of his soul, the director of his life. He also reveals within himself the laws of thought and understands that ever-increasing accuracy, how the thought forces and mind elements operate in the shaping of his character, circumstances, and destiny. Thought and character are one. And as character can only manifest and discover itself through environment and circumstance, the outer conditions of a person's life will always be found to be harmoniously related to their inner state. This does not mean that a man's circumstances at any given time are an indication of his entire character, but that those circumstances are so intimately connected with some vital thought element within himself that for the time being, they're indispensable to his development. Wow. I'm going to share this because y'all really need to read this. The soul attracts that which it secretly harbors, that which it loves, and also that which it fears. It reaches the height of its cherished aspirations. It falls to the level of its unchastised desires, and circumstances are the means by which the soul receives its own. Every thought, seed sown, are allowed to fall into the mind and to take root there produces its own blossoming sooner or later into act and bearing its own fruitage of opportunity and circumstance. Good thoughts bear good fruit. Bad thoughts bear bad fruit. Wow. A man does not come to the almshouse or the jail by the tyranny of fate of circumstance, but by the pathway of groveling thoughts and base desires. Unbelievable. Circumstances do not make the man. It reveals him to himself. So, you know, the question I asked a couple weeks ago, is it that politics corrupts or corrupt people attracted to politics? I guess that's the answer. Circumstances don't make the man. It reveals him. Men do not attract that which they want, but that which they are. Their whims, fancies, and ambitions are thwarted at every step, but their innermost thoughts and desires are fed with their own food, be it foul or clean. Some powerful words here, child. Unbelievable. Here's a good part of this. Men are anxious to improve their circumstances, but are unwilling to improve themselves. They therefore remain bound. The man who does not shrink from self-crucifixion can never fail to accomplish the object upon which his heart is set. This is as true of earthly as of heavenly things. Even the man whose sole object is to acquire wealth must be prepared to make great personal sacrifices before he can accomplish his object. And how much more so he would realize a strong and well-poised life? That's a question. I'll put this in the link because y'all need to read it. As a man thinketh, so is he. A man can or may be honest in certain directions, yet suffer privations. A man may be dishonest in certain directions, yet acquire wealth. But the conclusion usually formed that the man fails because of his particular honesty, that the other prospers because of his particular dishonesty, is the result of a superficial judgment, which assumes that the dishonest man is always totally corrupt and that the honest man almost entirely virtuous. In the light of deeper knowledge and wider experience, such judgment is found to be erroneous. The dishonest man may have some admirable virtues, which the other does not possess. And the honest man, obnoxious vices, which are absent in the other. Anyway, folks, definitely have a read of this. Sometimes you've got to read something more than once for it to really sink in. And this is definitely worth having a look at. It says, you will be what you will be. Let failure find its false content in that poor word environment. But spirit scorns it and is free. It masters time, it conquers space. It cows that boastful trickster chance and bids the tyrant circumstance unknown and fill a servant's place. The human will that force unseen, the offspring of a deathless soul, can hew a way to any goal through walls of granite intervene. Be not impatient in delay, but wait as one who understands. When spirit rises and commands, the gods are ready to obey. Y'all need to read it. Y'all need to read it. Trust me. Such a sad situation. Denny says that the article is simply reiterating biblical principles. Well, y'all confused when you read the Bible, apparently. Yarnell, thank you so much. Miss Charlene says, what's the public, in specific West Bay West, think should happen as he remains an MP there and overall representative West Bay? In my opinion, this needs to be addressed immediately too. Well, unfortunately, there's not much, if you read the Constitution, that can be done to address that. This is where the voters need to really try to make better decisions. We should be teaching our young people from the earliest of ages about civics and encouraging them to be leaders in their own right, you know, in middle school and so on, student associations and other such things, because there's quite a bit that they could learn from a very early age. And like I said, the desire to improve in life means that you have to constantly be working towards something. And you cannot cut off your own face, your own nose, as the saying goes, to spite your own face. There are times in life when we have to learn to get out of our own way. Miss Lalette says, one thing I like about you, don't care what the topic is, you tell the truth on the solid facts, that is, about it, no covering up. And you're very detailed with your explanation and transparent as possible. Well, I try to break it down because I think that sometimes, you know, you just don't get it if it's not broken down to that level. Jennifer says, word on the street is Mr. Panton has no control over his crew. From what I hear, Minister Jay even threw a chair at the premiere. Well, I can tell you I heard that rumor and I can now defunct that with confidence. Let me say this about the premiere. You know, I listen to a lot of these guys and I hear a lot of stuff and I know some of them are duplicitous and shady and, you know, and one breath they're like, oh, I don't want to be the premiere. I don't want to be the leader. And nothing could be farther from the truth. If they had the opportunity, if they thought that they could overthrow their own government and become premier, they would do so. So once again, I don't know why they're lying to me because, I mean, they must think I believe it. I'm like, this just means I'd be sipping on my little water. Or my little pep said the days I'd be cheating on that diet. And I'd be like, you don't want premiership, really? No. The premier is a good leader, Sandra. He's a good leader. I'm like, oh, okay. All right. Jennifer, what I can say to you is I can feel confident and tell you that no chair was thrown at the premier. I don't know where that rumor got started. Probably another progressive-based rumor. But you know, I think we all have an impression of the premier as being very cool, calm, and collected. However, I think he, from what I have, the observations that I've made, is he is that way because the day that he ever has somebody do something like throw a chair at him, it probably wouldn't end well for the other party. So, you know, everybody knows their limitations in life, right? And we all know, gosh, I don't want to get to that 100% where I'm going to be the ignorant fool. I'm going to be the McKeeva Bush of the group and have to smack somebody down for throwing a chair at me. So, you know, if he has to get up and go out of a room to cool down or whatever, they have their moments just like everybody else where they're not going to agree in everything. And they can have discourse that even sometimes gets animated and so on. I mean, I guess that's their right to do so. I just don't want them doing it with civil servants because I think that's where they cross the line. But amongst themselves, if that's how politics is in this country, then, you know, we've seen in other legislative assemblies around the world or parliaments, they throw shoes at each other and all sorts of stuff. But you can rest assured, Jennifer, that that didn't happen to the premier. Trust me, I fact checked that one and it didn't happen. Because I think his response would show y'all exactly how much control he does have. So let's just leave it at that. Remy, you bringing me lunch today? What? What's on tap for lunch? You're welcome, Miss Charlene. Dana says, as always, you never leave the truth untold. God bless you, Sandy. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Katsina says, the premier likes to march in the LGBTQ parade. Is it very good? It is very good at that. Oops. Well, Katsina, your comment will gain no favor here as a person who is supportive of the LGBTQ plus community. I will not discriminate against these people who have done us nothing wrong. They are your sisters and brothers that want to live in their own truth. I am more concerned about politicians who can't live in their own truth, who be singing in the church choirs and pretending to be the best Christians, and they should actually be part of that LGBTQ community themselves. Are y'all willing to hear that truth this morning? Are you willing to hear the truth about the politicians who like to mess with little boys? But yet they'd be the first ones to jump up against the LGBT community because they're fooling y'all with their lies? Who are offering young men $1,000 for fellatio? Do we need to have that conversation about your Christian church-going, church-singing politicians? I don't think y'all ready for the truth. Leave that community alone, because enough of them could tell you about your own husbands and wives who are stepping in the LGBTQ plus pool, and not just stepping in it, swimming freely. That's why some of them have to be traveling overseas, because y'all don't know what they be doing. Talk that for a minute. I'm just saying, I agree with Shannon. Stop the homophobic BS. None of that is going to make your life 1 ounce better. If the premier wants to be supportive of all marginalized communities in this country, then go for it. Knock yourself out. That is not your issue. That's the truth. And like I said, enough of them are dabbling in it. Y'all don't want to know what they be doing, honey child. But they're lying to y'all and you believe in the lies. Good morning, caller.
Yeah, good morning, Sandra. It's me again. I'm calling. Mm-hmm. Listen, you see, we in the situation we in.
Mm-hmm.
We talking about politicians and their dirtiness.
Mm-hmm.
And you gonna come and bring the LGBTQ.
You understand? What? Yes.
What? Listen to me. I would rather parade myself in purple, pink, and blue, and all the colors, and color my hair, my toes, than parade with them. Mm-hmm. I would rather do that every day than parade myself with some of the politicians and their dirtiness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? Mm-hmm. And this is a double standard that I do not like.
Yep.
That we as people have double standard on a word about this, but what I need to do is worry about those people that is in the church with incest, that in the church that is molesting children, in the church that doing the and I call them hidden homos. They are H. I say, what's the H? H right there. Because they're hidden homos, and I say it in not in a rude way, but you at least those people that parade themselves at least know what they are.
Exactly.
When you're in the church, raising your hand, and then you doing things in the closet, don't bring that. Listen, this is the reason why I don't like when people bring those things in this country. You have nothing else to say about the man but what he does in representing different people in this community. And I am not homosexual, but I will not stand against them because they have the constitutional right like any one of us. Any one of us. So I don't like when people come with those comments. It to me, it shows ignorance. And what it really bothers me is that we're focused on those issues that don't do anything to our community.
Exactly.
Compared to other issues
like child molestation. Why aren't we willing to call them out on that?
Exactly. Call them out on that. And you know what, Sandra? For the longest time, you've been asking for the pedophile list of all of those sexual pedophiles. But no, because you know what? Half of them people on that list.
Exactly.
And half of them other people in the list will be your same representatives that come knocking on your door asking you to walk free.
Absolutely.
So I don't think the younger population now, and this is what then people need to understand. There are young people coming up in this community. They're still in high school. They're still in primary school. Their thought process is very different.
Yes.
Their thought process is about equality, gender equality, sexual equality, and racial equality. Wake up, people. That is your youngsters growing up here now. They're not going to tolerate your foolishness. And they're going to put all of those politicians accountable. If you hear 9-year-olds, 8-year-olds talking, they're putting on it accountable for everything that you do. I am happy to see it because it's about time that these young people start to get up and start to speak. And they don't speak lightly. They don't care who you are. They don't care where you're from, who you're for. And some of them are very disrespectful. And I'm not saying I'm for that. What I'm saying is this is the type of conversation that will create a generation that will have hatred towards the church that's supposed to be sacred on an embarrassment to this community. Embarrassment.
Exactly.
That's all I have to say.
Thank you, my dear. I appreciate it. Yes, let's leave the poor LGBTQ community out of this. They're not the ones who are ruining your country, Honey Chow. You have enough politicians who can do that for you. I mean, it's just ridiculous. All right, let's read some WhatsApp comments. Someone says, oh, don't forget that Alden boxed down Elio in the lunchroom. Who can forget that example of leadership? Oh, yes, thank you. Why y'all talking about Jay erroneously throwing a chair at Wayne Panton? What we know for a fact is that Alden, which to this day, I don't know how Elio, a Georgetowner, allowed little Alden, the nerd from Kurod, to box him. I mean, that I'm like, how did that happen? Well, Elio had too much lunch, and his belly was so full he couldn't box him back. But this is what your representatives are doing. This happened in the lunchroom of your House of Parliament at the time, the Legislative Assembly. Tell Alden must deny it. Tell him I said go ahead and deny it so we can pull out some more receipts. Another person says, good morning. While we can get somewhat understand Jay's so-called multiple visits to Honduras, why did the Speaker of the House travel on this recent trip? Did we, the people, pay for this unexplained purpose visit? That's a good question. Considering we know what the nature of the trip was, of course it's business as usual. I won't read what's in brackets. Oh, what the hell? Let me read it. This is the cold hard truth after all. It says whoring and the buying of affections of females. There we go. When you elect the likes of some of these people who don't have enough discipline to even finish high school, and they say they have evidence of other disturbing behavior. Oh, Jesus, Lord have mercy. What a mess. Y'all need to stop. Mm-mm. Somebody says, brilliant job on Richie Barton and Roy. I love when you bring your receipts. There's lots of receipts, honey chill. This person says, anonymous, of course. I'm in no way sticking up for him, but truth is, he has an addiction problem. Oh, without a doubt. And we gave him the grace last week of saying, get help for your addiction problem. But again, the alcohol only reveals your true character. They say he's a different person when not under the influence. It's sad that he surrounds himself by people and handlers who don't look out for him. Why are they there? He needs to not drink. Well, when you have an addiction, that's hard. That's really hard when you have an addiction. You won't address the addiction. Here is the interesting thing about it. Is, you know, I was telling y'all on Thursday how the few people that try, you know, McKeeva does have a few friends that try to help him out, such as Graham Rankin. You know, Graham would be like, Mr. Bush, I'm not going to take you anywhere where you're going to be drinking, this and that. After midday, the drinking starts. What does McKeeva go and do? He goes and remove Graham from being his nighttime driver, hires a second nighttime driver, which, by the way, we're paying for, aren't we? Aren't we the people paying for that bill? For Miss Ava Thompson, I think that's her name, to drive around Mac at night so he can get all salty and drunk as a skunk. So poor Graham actually had his salary deducted because he no longer needed him as a nighttime driver and hired a second nighttime driver. You would be surprised the MPs who were giving special requests for special drivers, because the drivers know the things that they be up to, where they're going and hiding out and who they're hooking up with, that the poor wives don't have a clue. If you wives ever want to know the truth, y'all just pick up my phone and call me. Y'all know my direct number, 324-1612. I will tell you the truth as a wife, Nina. Because some of y'all need to know what the devil's you dealing with. All right. Someone else says, don't forget, speaking of politicians, everybody's remembering all the foolishness that politicians have been doing. Linford's threat to bust up Ronnie Dunn. Who put Cowich in Truman's jacket? I mean, these are just examples of how our politicians have been horrible from day one. And they're not changing. Oh, someone's asked me about the video with the police at Wellis. That's tomorrow's show. Y'all tune in tomorrow for that. This person says, Sandy, I almost ran off the road this morning laughing so hard at your Alberga impersonation. What a mess. Shame, shame, shame. This person says, this is what happens when you have too many boys in the camp. They know nothing about protocol. The government don't need no more newbies. They need a proven, matured person that knows the laws and protocols of our country. They don't need, they don't have time to train anyone. Make sure you know all of the mishaps. You be best to say every government has had trouble with him. Mind his mommy, get you, well, get you for her boy. Isn't, which mother were you referring to? Isn't his mother dead? I hope she's not going to be coming from the grave for me. They say that Wayne has a job in his hand to manage. Remember, you all wanted the young blood. So there you go. And I mean, listen, whether it's young blood or old blood, that doesn't have anything to do with political maturity and even individual maturity. There's some young people who are way more mature. And we've just pointed out that for all of his years of politics, for you to argue that Alden is the most mature person in the bunch would be problematic at best. Former politician says, like your program, you were smart. Try not to use the Cayman expletives on your show. Use the proper word. You all Caymanians know what we're talking about, don't you? I listen to your program at times. Okay. Someone else says, another senior person in the community says, Sandra, I've been listening with keen interest to your show this morning and did not think to check my messages until now. Yes. So this is historically what else has happened that I was trying to, I wasn't here then, so I couldn't remember these facts. But this person says, during the 1988 to 1992, there was an attempt to pull a coup by the then leader of the opposition, Truman Baden, who at the time commanded 8 out of the 12 elected seats. Mr. Bush, who was then a member of the opposition, played a very active role in this move. Surprised. To the extent that he was the mover of the requisite legislation in 1989, the purpose and effect of which was to permanently remove the governor, Alan Scott, from the chair and replace him with a speaker. Wow, some people really have been at it for a minute. He would later go on to form the government of 1992 to 96 with Mr. Baden, who would remove and replace him as the member for health midterm. Lord Jesus, wow. All have been at it forever. My goodness, such bad behavior. This person says, until we the people of Cayman elect 85% of women to our parliament, we will not see change for the better. They said McKeeva should not have been allowed to run. Then we wouldn't be in this damn mess again. But remember, nothing could stop him from running unless he actually got a conviction, like an actual conviction of a year or more in prison. And that didn't happen. Pastor Clark, this message is for you. This person says Pastor Clark cannot talk because he slept with one of the church members, got her pregnant, had to step down from the pulpit for a while. His brother had to preach while he adopted the child because the wife couldn't have any children. So he is no different than McKeeva Bush. Lord Jesus, take the wheel on that one. Take the whole church bus while you're at it. What a mess. Oh my gosh. This one says the forest was shrinking, but the trees kept voting for the axe. For the axe was clever and convinced the trees that because his handle was made of wood, he was one of them. That one is quite interesting. I got to save that, honey Jill. Thank you. Wow, that's kind of deep. This person says the victims always suffer. What a mess. Oops, time for the trickery to stop. You know, I think the bottom line really is the people have had enough. Speaking of trickery, Miss Cayman committee continues to trick us all into thinking that they are doing something when they're actually not. So we sent some questions to them over the weekend. And they responded by saying, basically, they're not going to do anything to the reigning Miss Cayman universe. And I understand it because they can't do anything because they allowed her to run to begin with, with their slack criteria in place. So if they now tried to implement new criteria, she would have a valid reason to sue them, and she should have. But nonetheless, they've allowed her to keep the crown. She gets all of her winnings, and she's going to get a stipend to sit down and do nothing because DOT don't want her while this is pending. Because again, that's against the good principles of all civil servants. When you get arrested, you cannot be on the job working. So she's staying at home playing in a little kiddie pool because she's posting all this stuff on social media. So unfortunately, y'all keep sending it to me. I don't follow her in social media. Having her best life at the expense of the people of the Cayman Islands. So we are paying her a stipend, folks. After she beat up all these people. But Lord knows, today is September the 20th, the 17th of the month. I think that's her trial. Can't come quick enough. I will be there reporting live and direct. And I hope to God the committee members who have believed her cockamamie stories show up as well. So they can hear the police statements. They can hear the eyewitnesses for themselves. Do you think any of the committee members are going to show up? Dara Lee Dakers, put in your vacation time from now for the trial, please. Show up. Because we know you don't really care. Giving her a stipend. And then here are the audacity of them. Oh, she's not going to make any public appearances. She's all over social media, posting every other minute. Never posted so much in her life. She actually made the announcement that the venue has been changed for the upcoming Miss Cayman pageant, Miss Universe. So she's making the announcement. I don't even think the committee themselves have made the announcement. Meanwhile, they're talking about, oh, she's not going to be in the public eye or making any appearances, really. No, sir. Y'all not ready. Not ready, none at all. So this was the agreement that they made with the ministry some weeks back, that she would not be making any public appearances. The agreement was made on, what are we at, September 20th? The agreement was made, I believe, on the, would it have been Wednesday the 31st or the 7th? No, I think it was the 31st. What day did she go on an interview with that guy? That was like the 5th, right? Let me see now. I'm trying to remember. September. No, I think her interview was the 9th and the agreement was made like maybe the 7th. My dates could be a little bit off, but the point is the agreement was made with the ministry on the Wednesday. No public appearances. By the Friday, she was doing an online interview with this Telemundo guy. What is their definition of a public appearance? Doing an interview online is a public appearance. That's how they're done in the 21st century now. These people are just unbelievable. They're not ready. No, sir. Rhonda says, speak it, caller, to that last caller. Oh, the Wellies incident. We got to tackle that tomorrow, y'all. In case you don't know about it, on the face of it, it looks like our police officers are using excess force. And we want to talk to the victim in the Wellies incident. The police do themselves zero favors when they carry on in an unprofessional manner. But don't worry, they're coming right up tomorrow. And speaking of that, I have some very good intel on what is going on with the investigation of the little child in Cayman Brac. I am shocked and saddened that the police have issued nothing on this, because even if 50% of what I'm hearing is true, Houston, we have got a major problem and it ain't looking good. Aquina says, wait a minute, don't use Caymanian expletives. What an insult. We not Caymanians? Well, honey child, Bobo and Didi. What can I say? What can I say? Dana says, I'm not Caymanian, but I love Sandy's display of pure Caymanian culture through her words. And I'm not really the best with it, Dana, to be honest, because I grew up over there in America for far too long. But you know, I've been back a little minute now. Listen to me, folks. 9:56 is the time. I want y'all to listen to. There's a really good song that I'm going to play for y'all that I want y'all to listen to. And then after that, we're going to queue up the news. So continue to listen. I think the radio might end in the meantime, but I want to encourage you guys to listen to the words of this song, because the words of this song are extremely powerful and correct on topic today, as it counts when we talk about politics. We cannot continue to be hoodwinked by the politicians.
In your face, them a smile up. Behind your back, a money, them a pile up. Try for start your business and them quick for spoil up. Hey, well done, well done, Mr. Politician man. You done a wonderful job at tear down with country demolition man. Sibili bang, well done. Well done, Mr. Politician man. You done such a great job selling out with country with your business plan. Well, you forget a round of applause
for all the work you're doing. Decisions where you make, we left the country in our ruins, yo. Strictly personal gain you're pursuing, so the tax rate higher than the planes where you're flew in. We gon' make your deal with the IMF. No, we're not a box sign, not a sugar cane left. The hotels and the beaches, the Spanish them go screeching. Me no know how you do it, but all my office say is well done, well done, Mr. Politician man.
I must congratulate you.
You done a wonderful job at here done with country demolition man. Skibbly bang, well done, well done, Mr. Politician man. You done such a great job selling out with country with your business plan.
What kind of plan?
Which is to keep poverty and unemployment on the rise. Corruption and not to mention the lies. Election and when the tension arise. So you buy with Kentucky not to mention the fries. Anything to secure your vote. And then you rob the people to secure your boat. We go up, go Thailand where the Chinese own. The whole Jamaica is a Chinese loan. I tell you well done, well done, Mr. Politician man.
How are you treating
me so? You done a wonderful job at here down with country demolition man. Skibbly bang, well done, well done, Miss Politician lady. You done such a great job selling out with country and you still no pay with. But still if inflation was success you would not get A plus. So when me met the US the exchange rate buck. God the dollar getting weaker and the solar light bill it would have cheaper. But a JPS you pray for keep ya Ebenezer. So you scrooge from the ghetto people where you starve and every year you buy a better vehicle. The things you do are beat with bad but still you manage to keep your job. So me I tell you well done, well done. Well done, Mr. Politician man. You done a wonderful job at tear down with country demolition man. Skibbly bang, well done, well done, Miss Politician lady. You done such a great job selling out with country. Come here like Humpty Dumpty now. Congratulate them, you know. Yeah man, give thanks for the effort, you know. Yeah man, enough things do not go on it, you know. But you them see it still, so we give thanks. Yeah man, gangster, kabab papi. Okay.
Hello, I'm Kevin Wattler, and this is your CMR Daily Buzz.
Cayman's delegation at the funeral of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, led by His Excellency Governor Martin Roper and Premier Wayne Panton, paid respects to Her Late Majesty in Westminster Hall on Saturday. Both Governor Roper and Premier Panton said it was an emotional and moving moment for the delegation, which included Mrs. Roper, Mrs. Panton, Cabinet Secretary Sam Rose, and Dr. Tasha Garcia, head of the London office. Premier Panton signed a condolence book with other premiers at Lancaster House, and afterward, the team was invited by the Speaker of the House of Commons, Sir Lindsay Hoyle, to have tea in his rooms and apartment with other overseas territories leaders. Mr. Panton and Governor Roper then attended a moment of reflection at the Cayman Islands Government Office with the Cayman community in the UK, where they all were invited to sign a condolence book and record on video their memories of the late Queen. Governor Roper described the occasion as a beautiful event. A contingent of six Royal Cayman Islands Police Service officers also traveled to London for the funeral of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. The officers attended the funeral parade and participated along the route of the procession, assisted with crowd control and essential general policing duties. Deputy Governor the Honourable Franz Manderson has issued a message to civil servants clarifying what employment contracts state regarding reporting of wrongdoing. This is in response to allegations that Speaker of the House the Honourable McKeeva Bush made unwanted advances and assaulted several female civil servants. The statement said, "I am aware of recent media reports concerning allegations of assault by a Member of Parliament against female civil servants who were attending an official event on September 13th. I am also aware of media conversations that have suggested that civil servant employment contracts restrict the ability of civil servants to report matters to police or other official reporting bodies, which is incorrect. Our workplace rules both allow and encourage the reporting of wrongdoing. As head of the civil service, I wish to make it clear that we are committed to ensuring the safety of our employees and protecting their rights, including their right to report wrongdoing. The civil service has a zero tolerance for misconduct. The deputy governor then added that the allegations of assault are under Royal Cayman Islands Police Service investigation, so he would not comment any further. Meanwhile, Premier the Honourable Wayne Panton confirmed that he issued a strongly worded letter to McKeeva Bush before his London trip on Thursday afternoon, suggesting he resign on or before this Friday. Bush confirmed via WhatsApp that he will be resigning. Premier Panton confirmed that he was waiting until after the official period of mourning of the late Her Majesty Elizabeth II before issuing any further statement on the matter. The Miss Cayman Islands Universe Committee has confirmed that no action will be taken against the reigning Queen Tiffany Connolly at this time. Over a month ago, they claimed they were on a fact-finding mission and seeking legal advice. However, they are now claiming she will be keeping all of the awarded prizes, including her $70,000 three-year scholarship. Despite her not being allowed to work at the Department of Tourism, she will be receiving a stipend in lieu of a salary until further notice. Responding to media questions from CMR in a brief follow-up statement, the committee did not reveal what their investigations found or the outcome of the legal advice sought. Instead, they now state they will await the outcome of her criminal assault case before any further action will be taken. The Department of Labor and Pensions has confirmed that labor laws regarding public holidays apply to Monday, September 19th, which has been declared a public holiday by the government in honor of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II's state funeral. CMR reached out to the department following numerous questions from our audience. If someone is being forced to work without the legal compensation, you are encouraged to contact the Department of Labor and Pensions. In light of announced changes in COVID-19 reporting, the Public Health Spotlight will be published monthly instead of weekly. Monthly COVID-19 information will be limited to hospitalizations and deaths. However, notable increases in the number of hospitalizations as well as any deaths will be reported to the community immediately. The first monthly edition will be released on October 6th. Cayman National Corporation has announced that Janet Hislop has been nominated as its President and Chief Executive Officer and will join the Board of Directors effective January 1st, 2023. Ms. Hislop will also continue in her role as President and Director of CNC's principal subsidiary, Cayman National Bank Limited. In celebration of its 55 years relationship with the Cayman Islands, Flo Cayman has launched Cayman Blue, a program that will seek to enhance its presence in residential and business communities. Through programs like Cayman Blue, Flo said it will continue its legacy of investment and growth of Cayman and its commitment to connect communities and transform lives. The program will seek to enhance Flo's presence in Cayman's residential and business communities by extending the company's service and products into previously underserved or unserved areas and developing key partnerships with local institutions that provide services to those communities. Ministry of Sustainability and Climate Resiliency is planting 7 trees at the Queen Elizabeth II Botanic Park Children's Garden, one to honor each decade of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II's reign. Premier and Minister of Sustainability and Climate Resiliency, the Honourable Wayne Panton, planted the first tree near the Discovery Pond.
Stormwatch 2022 is brought to you by Home Gas, your propane experts before, during, and after the storm.
Hurricane Fiona will continue moving away from Puerto Rico and now will continue to impact the eastern Dominican Republic, causing life-threatening and catastrophic flooding. Turks and Caicos and southeastern Bahamas will then experience hurricane conditions, and at any moment, Fiona is expected to get stronger and turn into a Category 3 hurricane, giving it major hurricane status while it heads for Bermuda. Not good news for Bermuda at all. Elsewhere in the Atlantic, there are a couple of spots to watch. One of them is not going to bother anyone, but there is a tropical wave several hundred miles east of the Windward Islands that could develop as it approaches the eastern Caribbean Sea over the weekend. We need to watch this system very closely, and in the meantime, be storm ready, Cayman. Have everything ready from now and not wait till we have a system near us. Now for your CMR weather update is brought to you by WG Charters. Sunrise at 6:14, mainly sunny skies expected. The day heats up to the high 80s, but it will feel hotter than that. when the high temperature is at 87 degrees Fahrenheit and the humidity is at 70%, like the forecast calls for, it will feel around 100 degrees Fahrenheit. The wind's north at 5 to 10 miles per hour, and then the sun sets at 6:23. At nighttime, the temperature falls to the low 80s. Looking forward, similar summer pattern of hot days, warm nights with scattered showers is expected. CMR weather updates are brought to you by WG Charters. They offer private boat trips for a great price, and we encourage you to support them. Now for some regional and international news. Islands in the Caribbean are reeling from the damage caused by Hurricane Fiona. In Guadeloupe, one man was killed and 20 others had to be rescued when then-tropical storm Fiona hit the French Caribbean island. Fiona reached hurricane strength by time it hit Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic, causing an island-wide blackout in Puerto Rico. Turks and Caicos and southeastern Bahamas and Bermuda is now in the path of the dangerous hurricane. Three people were killed and at least six others were injured when a gunman fired shots at fans at a football game in Old Harbor, Jamaica, Sunday afternoon. Reports are that a dispute over missing illegal guns was the motive behind the attack. A licensed firearm holder at the match reportedly challenged the gunman, who then fled. As of September 7th, more than 1,000 people were murdered in Jamaica, a 7.4 increase in the country's homicide tally when compared to 2021. Telecommunications company Digicel says the ongoing political crisis in Haiti is having a major impact on its operations, with many of its optical fibers being stolen or severely damaged due to the ongoing gang violence. In a statement, Digicel said due to the difficulty of moving across the country, operations such as the maintenance and repair of antennas and fiber optics and all other operation activities have become more difficult. A man was sentenced to 2.5 years in prison by a Bahamian court after admitting to breaking into a church and stealing $6 worth of hot dog buns. 41-year-old Elkino Wallace told officers he was starving and was charged with shop breaking and stealing from a place of worship. Reports are that on September 13th, Wallace broke into the East Street Gospel Chapel through a window and he went to the kitchen of the church's auditorium where he stole the food. A deacon alerted the police to the break-in. Wallace admitted to the offense and was arrested on scene. When he appeared in court on Thursday, he pleaded guilty to both charges. According to local reports, Wallace, who asked for the court's mercy, told the magistrate that he was beaten shortly before the incident and had no choice but to go to the church. Wallace said he needed a monthly injection for an unstated medical condition. A poultry farm in Blue Creek Village in northwest Belize has been placed under quarantine by the Belize Agriculture Health Authority after it detected the avian influenza, more commonly known as bird flu, in its birds. Bird flu is an infectious type of influenza that spreads among birds, and in rare cases, it can affect humans. The health authority said the farm currently houses over 25,000 chickens, and containment measures are being implemented to restrict poultry products exiting the Blue Creek community. While paying tribute to the late Queen Elizabeth II on Tuesday, Jamaica's opposition spokesperson on foreign affairs, Lisa Hanna, renewed a call by former colonies for Britain to confront its colonial atrocities and make amends for slavery and its repercussions. She was among several politicians who paid tribute in the House of Representatives. She asserted that Britain's authorities must recognize that the country's approach to its past had been and continues to be misaligned with current expectations of their former colonies. The group of seven major economies have agreed to take a tougher, more coordinated stance toward China when it comes to trade, Germany's economy minister said on Thursday. After a two-day meeting with fellow G7 officials, Minister for Economic Affairs and Climate Protection Robert Habeck told reporters that discussions about China were part of an effort to ensure high international trade standards to prevent Beijing from using its economic might to steamroll other nations. That's it for now on The Daily Buzz. Thank you for joining me. Please stay safe and God bless.
Thank you for tuning in to another episode of The Cold Hard Truth on Bobo 89.1 FM. Cayman's number one talk show is live weekdays from 7:30 a.m. Never miss an episode again. Watch anytime on CMR's Facebook and YouTube channels for the latest show episodes. Don't forget to follow us online on our social media channels. And visit CaymanMarlRoad.com for all the latest news and community happenings.